Okay, guys, let's get started for today. Starting with the very first question. Just give me a sec so that I fix the other aspects. Okay, fine. So, what we'll be doing is a quick assessment of your preparation. I presume that you guys have, revised your topics well, and we can get started. Okay, fine, fine, guys. I'm perfectly fine. We start with the first question for today, so just keep the the comments on with respect to the answers, and we can save a lot of time in rather than exchanging pleasantries. So starting with the first one, it talks about a two-person team. I mean, you are the intern on duty, you have cleared the exam, and now you are posted in the emergency room, and your responsibility is to give CPR for any crashing patient. Crashing would imply that any patient who goes into any kind of a hemodynamic compromise, that's the bottom line. I mean, it could be a tachyarrhythmia, it could be a bradyarrhythmia, it could be a post-acute coronary syndrome that these manifestations could be occurring. And you are giving chest compressions, and your colleague in this point is giving rescue breaths. So, I mean, you need a coordination, and you very well know the ratio that is going to be 30 to 2. So, hi, Shushant, I'm perfectly fine. So, let's just focus on the questions at the hand. I'm having varied responses between option number B and D. So let's read about. He says which of the following is correct. A says depth of the chest compression should be at least 2 cm. Well, a grossly wrong statement, because it's about gonna be 2 or 2.5 inches. So in adults it should be approximately 5 cm. So we can rule out option number A. B says ask your colleague to check carotid pulse after every completion of 30 to 2 cycle. Well, I would call that a very silly option, primarily because if you're gonna break the cycle, or you're gonna break the continuation of chest compressions, or if your friend is not gonna give that rescue breaths and is gonna be wasting time checking for carotid pulse, it means that you are not doing everything perfect. In fact, the biggest problem would be that if you're gonna do it after completion of every cycle. You see, intermittently, when you're giving CPR to a patient, obviously you want to be sure that, okay, when you give chest compressions, it should produce an effective carotid pulsation. But my point is, if you are gonna do it that on a regular basis every cycle, then that means that you are interrupting the continuity of the cycle. So that rules out option number B. A couple of guys in my group had actually mentioned regarding option number B. So I wanna highlight this fact again, guys, because that was the first answer that couple of chaps gave. Read the statement carefully. He says, ask your colleague to check the carotid pulse after completion of every cycle. You do it intermittently or at some point of time between couple of cycles, it is fine, because you want to see that your chest compression is fine. Because after all, you are compressing the heart between the sternum and the vertebra. So you want to see that there is an effective carotid pulsation, but doing it on a regular basis really does not make sense. C says intermittently stop chest compressions. That's anyway gross statement, because one guy has to be continuously working on giving or delivering chest compressions to the patient. I mean, the problem here is stopping the chest compressions. You're left between, I mean, you can solve the first question on the basis of exclusion. The correct answer would be option number delta, and that's a standard protocol which you guys have to remember, that if you are the team leader. Let's assume you are standing at the foot end of the patient and you are the team leader. One of your juniors is giving chest compression, other is giving rescue breaths. Then the guy who's giving chest compressions will really get tired. In fact, if you have ever given chest compressions, you will really understand what I mean, because you really need a good cardiovascular system of your own to deliver good quality chest compressions. So because of the fatigue factor that would come in, because of the fatigue factor that would come in, the guy who's giving chest compression has to be given a break. So the guy who's actually giving rescue breaths can take your position, and you can go and switch position with him. And this should be done every 5 cycles. I mean, that's the basic American Heart Association guidelines for basic life support. And any exam you sit for, whether it's going to be, a NEET PG exam, a MCI exam, a PLAB exam, or USMLE, I mean, they standard come up with these answers. So I'm really happy. Yes, Manisha, you were bang spot on. Javed, you were spot on. Riya, great, great. So the answer to this question is option number delta. Thanks, Gurjeet, for the feedback. I mean, I would just like to keep on doing this job so that you guys can improve your concentration and are able to improve your strike rate as well. So quick recall for question number one for people who are joining in. Option number A is wrong because it says 2 cm, it should be 5 cm. Beta is wrong because if you interrupt the cycle on a regular basis, you are gonna decrease the cerebral perfusion and that's gonna contribute to cerebral anoxia. I mean, point number B will definitely contribute to damage to the brain. Every few seconds, when there is no blood supply to the brain, a few million neurons will anyway start dying. So effectively, we are pushing the patient back by a couple of years. And when I can say push the patient back by a couple of years, it basically implies the fact that neuronal blood supply is very critical. I mean, any interruption is not warranted. So this cycle is definitely not gonna be, I would say, interrupted at any point of time. And the guy who's giving chest compressions has to be given a break because he would get tired. So you need to switch positions or swap positions per se. Answer to question number one is delta. Good job by most of you. So usually that happens. Opening MCQ, when it goes right, no, it gives you that, you know, that boost, that mega boost, that adventure thing that or that kick that comes in that, okay, man, I am bang on spot. We move on to the second one for today. It says which of the following is not a feature of raised intracranial pressure. Definition of raised intracranial pressure, you very well know the fact normal pressure in the brain is going to be approximately 10 to 20 millimeters of mercury. So every time the pressure spikes up more than 20, goes in the range of 25 or more for a duration more than 5 minutes, we call it a raised ICP in a person. Now, the moment that happens, I mean, there's a distinct chance that the patient can undergo a brain herniation. Aisha says point number C. Rahul, Vivek, most guys are coming with option number C. I'm having a B and a D coming up as well. So, I mean, we are having varied responses. So let's just solve it, right? Guys, what happens in person with raised intracranial pressure is that the reticular activating system will be compressed. Reticular activating system is what keeps us alert, what keeps us awake. Like, let me say, hypothetically speaking, if you are listening to medicine and you're feeling sleepy, what will you do? Either you will discontinue listening to medicine or you're going to take a strong coffee and say, okay, man, I'm going to put in my best effort. But in a person of raised ICP, right, because there is a raise of pressure, so the blood supply to the reticular activating system, which keeps us alert and awake, is reduced. This contributes to development of altered sensorium. So option number D is definitely a feature. In any patient of raised ICP, they have always asked in the exam which nerve will always be involved. So usually we get a sixth nerve palsy. In fact, that's also called as false localizing sign. So you would also be having diplopia looking laterally. You are left between option number B and delta, B and C. Now you are getting into, you know, that groove and realizing, okay, where are you going wrong? See, guys, in any patient who's having Kernick sign is a sign of meningeal irritation. It does not mean the fact that the person is suffering from raised ICP. Kernick sign is just simply implying the fact that the person is having a meningitis problem. Why would you be getting a hemiplegia? Because when the pressure in the brain will rise, listen to my words very carefully. When the pressure in the brain will rise, the midbrain will get compressed. Then the pons will get compressed, then the medulla will get compressed. So because of the compression of these important parts of the brain, there can also be compression of the corticospinal pathway. The compression of the corticospinal pathway will result in development of hemiplegia. So when the patient's brain is having a swelling, it puts pressure on the corticospinal pathway. I've written the word uncle herniation. That basically means midbrain herniation because होता ऐसे ही है ना, पहले midbrain का herniation होता है, फिर pons का होता है, फिर medulla का होता है. So अगर किसी person में there's gonna be a development of a midbrain herniation or uncle herniation, it's gonna press on the crus cerebri. Now, if you go through my discussion in the app or you listen to anatomy, or a lot of you might be, you know, listening at the moment are junior students, then I want you to recall the fact that midbrain mein jo crus cerebri present hota hai, that's gonna have the corticospinal pathway, so it will get crushed. And that would contribute to hemiplegia as well. So don't be under impression that hemiplegia is something that you see only with stroke. After all, stroke will also cause raised ICP only, na? Hemorrhagic stroke anyway causes raised ICP. Ischemic stroke can have a secondary hemorrhage and causes a raised ICP. The bottom line is the correct answer to this MCQ, guys, is Bombay. Why? Because primarily because of the fact that when it comes to karnic sign, it's basically indicating the fact that the person is suffering from meningitis per se. So I hope you recall or you understand by attempting this question that you see in the actual exam, you would always be having confusion between two close options. So my request to you guys is to sharpen your reflexes, attend these discussions, or if you don't want to attend them on a regular basis, do it by yourself. That, you know, when you do multiple choice questions, see whether your first instinct is correct or incorrect, because most of the time the first instinct, the first answer that you mark is the correct one, right? So you need to understand your instincts. That's very, very important, because lots of time we guys towards the end, because we put the questions for mark for review, to hota kya hai ki we tend to, you know, we tend to then change our answers, and that definitely causes a decrease in marks or, you know, borderline situation for anybody. So I would like you to be just doing this on a regular basis, and you would on your be way for glory, right? Answer to question number 2 is Bombay, guys. Karnic sign simply indicates meningeal irritation, and between I've explained why hemiplegia would be seen, and that's primarily uncal herniation. Crus cerebri is the one which would be crushed in this case, and that's one of the early manifestations that you see. I mean, before I say posturing occurring, you know, if in this MCQ option number C was posturing, everybody would have got this question right. Everybody would have marked option number B. But the point is, posturing is a late feature. You know, pehle decorticate posturing occurs, then decerebrate posturing occurs. So in any patient, you have an uncal herniation, a midbrain herniation, pontine, and then a medulla. So posturing is occurring subsequently to the development of hemiplegia. Yes, Ruchit, sometimes the gut feeling always works. I mean, you need to think from your, I'll put it like this: gut feeling, heart feeling, and then a brain feeling. We doctors have 3 feelings. So that brain, gut, and heart may say, it is ultimately the brain that has to be fine-tuned for the correct options. Answer to question number 2 is Bombay. We move to the third one, relatively an easier one. I think GI is something that most guys are very comfortable with. So I'm very, very sure that everybody would be able to answer this correctly. We have this 50-year-old chap, and he's having chronic constipation and fresh blood in the stool for last 6 months. He says, which of the following would be a least likely cause? We very well know the fact that in any person who's having lower GI bleeding, fresh blood in the stool, if a person is having hematochezia, then one of the important causes of fresh blood in the stool is diverticulitis. Obviously, piles is very much there, but overall, I would say when you start going towards the age of 50, 60, 70, diverticulitis is one gonna be one important. Yes, guys, I'm waiting for your answer. I'm getting ulcerative colitis as an answer. So, guys, please comment. Right. Please do comment on this fact that don't you have blood in the stool in ulcerative colitis? I mean, constipation could be a accessory fact, no? It's not a guarantee that all ulcerative colitis patients will have diarrhea. I mean, is it a necessity? Right, because of dietary habits, and he does not take sufficient fiber, he does not drink sufficient water, and he takes a lot of non-veg, there is a distinct possibility that person could be having chronic constipation coming up. So blood in the stools is anyway seen in ulcerative colitis, right? And colorectal cancer mein toh waise bhi blood in the stool aa sakta na. Colorectal cancer ka toh basic presentation yahi hai na. This is gonna be tenesmus. The person is gonna be having a sense of incomplete evacuation of the bubble. The chap is gonna say, I go to the washroom, I defecate, but I still feel as if there's still some fecal matter behind, so I go to the washroom again and again, and still I feel as if my tummy is not clear. So most patients after 50-60, if they have a chronic constipation progressive with bleeding, then definitely you would be having colorectal cancer. But if you look at sigmoid volvulus, guys, it's mainly gonna present with large bubble obstruction. And another point against sigmoid volvulus at the moment would be even possibility of chronic constipation, because sigmoid volvulus is anyway gonna have an acute presentation. Even if you argue the fact that okay, a person with sigmoid volvulus can't he be having a presentation of chronic constipation, I agree to the fact, but that's why the question is saying which of the following is the least likely presentation. Dr. Rajni, silly mistakes keep on occurring. That's a normal happening that we see. Yes, Saurav, most of the cases that we see are gonna be having this traditional presentation that we see only. That is blood in the stool with chronic constipation with all of them, except this would be the least likely possibility. Diverticulosis is a prerequisite for diverticulitis. No, I mean, you don't have diverticulitis occurring just like that. People who are having chronic constipation in the sigmoid colon develop culosis, and the chap with culosis will then be having an inflammation because that mouth of the diverticula could be blocked by the fecal matter. Na? Yes, a multiple diverticula are formed in the sigmoid colon of this guy. And those fecolits, you know, I'm just saying hypothetically, the fecolith is causing opening blockage of the mouth of the diverticula. So there would be definitely, growth of bacteria here, and the toxins which are produced here will definitely cause damage to the mucosa that can cause the bleed manifestation. Overall, the bleeding cause of rectal bleed in, see, old age is a very non-specific answer. First answer is piles for Prashant that you put up. Otherwise, I did have option number B coming up again. That's what I'm saying, Khushdeep. Why B is not to be considered? Because ulcerative colitis will anyway be having fresh blood in the stools, no? And it would be, I would say, a long-standing complaint in a patient. But if you look at C, that would be an acute presentation. So very unlikely to unlikely to have, you know, blood in the stools primarily as a presentation of sigmoid volvulus. Okay, so I hope it's clear, guys. In the group per se, what I'm seeing is initially Javed or other chaps, doesn't matter. I mean, if I take your name, don't mind it. Even if your answer goes wrong, it's just that I'm trying to point out the fact that between two close options, try to, you know, focus on the wordings of the question. Because sigmoid volvulus, though, I have taught you, is one of the leading causes of large bowel obstruction in a patient. Okay, the answer to question number 3C, we are sorted for this one. We move to the fourth one for today. The question says, which of the fluid would not be given? No, Mihira, it's not a recorded one, it's a live one. Okay. Okay. Rahul, gastropexy, we'll discuss that when we discuss surgery sometime with respect to, you know, stomach volvulus. Let's focus on the job at hand at the moment and let's not go off the track. Shushant, yeah, possible, it can cause shock, but then again the bleed manifestation would be very unlikely, or I would say very late. That is why the question said least likely. The question did not say unlikely. Okay, guys, we are having now a fight between option number B and D coming up. The question says, which of the following would not be given in a patient of metabolic alkalosis? You see, the bottom line is, in any patient of metabolic alkalosis, bicarbonate is gonna be on the higher side, and if you give anything that will increase the bicarbonate further, it will deteriorate the patient. Now, when you read about Ringer lactate, you see Ringer lactate has lactate present, and this lactate will be metabolized by the liver. So the moment you give Ringer lactate to this patient, this lactate will be contributing to excess production of bicarbonate. And if you produce excess bicarbonate, then this metabolic alkalosis is going to deteriorate in a patient. I mean, that's a standard dictum that is taught to us in medical school, that you are supposed to give Ringer lactate in a chap with metabolic acidosis. You're not supposed to give Ringer lactate to a chap with metabolic alkalosis. The correct answer to this question is Bombay still, because there was a initial hiccup coming up and there were some issues, so I want to highlight. In metabolic acidosis, yes, you do give Ringer lactate, but then you need to keep a watch on the potassium values of a person, because, like, for example, a person is having a acute kidney injury, potassium is increasing, though, yes, even in kidney injury, you are having metabolic acidosis, I'll not give Ringer lactate. Why? Because the potassium values would anyway be spiking in the chat. And if they ask you what is the preferred fluid for metabolic alkalosis, please comment in the chat box, guys, waiting in my group also. Yes, guys, quickly, what is the preferred fluid of choice for management of metabolic alkalosis? Yes, Aditi, good evening. Yes, guys, come on, I'm waiting. I want you to have faster. I don't need to repeat myself again and again. Fluid of choice for metabolic alkalosis. Bolo, Dr. Saab. Very good. Yes, that is normal saline. So I have brilliant chaps with me who are straightforward answering and very good Stifler, very good Rahul, very good Pramod. I mean, you guys are doing a great job. Metabolic acidosis is rigor-lactate, alkalosis is normal saline. Standard data, man, standard data. And then they teach you always. I mean, when would you not give rigor-lactate? That was the query that was put up in this question. So I would say that was relatively, I would say, a simpler one or relatively an easier one to pick up. For every condition, though, what I have done is I have mentioned regarding fluids to be used. Two chapters which I want you to be very thorough with. One is the electrolytes component. I mean, was hyponatremia, hypernatremia, hypokalemia, hyperkalemia, ये bread and butter है. मतलब वो medicine के जो question किसी भी exam में आते हैं ना, they love to always always ask you about sodium deficit. They love to ask you about correction for hypernatremia. And those formulas are given. And also take care कि वो deficit पूछ रहा है, correction पूछ रहा है. Right, because they are mathematical formulas, and I don't expect you to remember each formula per se, but then yeah, I mean, just go through that lecture on a loop. It's about, I think, 1 hour and 50 minutes, but I assure you the fact that if you go through that electrolytes wala, a lot of your pain, a lot of that trauma or torture that they cause in the actual exam with respect to electrolyte imbalance would definitely be sorted out. And good job by most of you. Yes, Javed, you came up with a perfect answer. Answer is B. Let's move on to the fifth one for today. Okay जी, I'll just slightly zoom it in so that you can see the exact fonts for science. Yogi, that's the next question that is actually coming up in shock. What is to be given? And I'll come to your query, Yogi, very quickly. You are the intern on duty. The senior resident will always write in the register. No, like in government hospital, GMC, you know, there's a register in which you write the admission provisional diagnosis. So your SR has mentioned the word septic shock and he's admitted the patient in intensive care unit. You very well know the fact that the most common cause for ICU admission, right? At the moment is either shock, septic shock, or it is acute kidney injury. I mean, majority of ICU admissions in the hospital are gonna be mainly sepsis or septic shock, because nowadays, especially secondary to COVID, patients end up with sepsis. Another aspect would be acute kidney injury. I mean, these two problems constitute to maximum ICU admissions. And he says that what would you be doing in this patient? So I have spot on answers. Guys, do read these words. No, सबसे पहले क्या करेंगे? Okay, I am having मल्टीपल रिस्पॉन्सेस, तो मतलब सभी कुछ हो गया है. नो, आई एम हैविंग एबीसीडी कमिंग अप रैंडमली. ओके, जस्ट टेल मी समथिंग. इन अ चैप विद शॉक, इन अ चैप विद शॉक, दैट मींस पेरिफेरल पल्सेस आर नॉट पेल्पेबल. व्हाट डू यू डू फर्स्ट? यू पुट अ वाइट बोर कैनला एंड यू स्टार्ट आईवी फ्लूइड्स ना. यू गिव अ फ्लूइड बोलस. द फर्स्ट थिंग इन एनी पेशेंट विद इधर अ सेप्टिक शॉक और हाइपोवोलेमिक शॉक, कार्डियोजेनिक शॉक छोड़ दो. कार्डियोजेनिक शॉक में हम पेशेंट को कभी भी आईवी फ्लूड नहीं देते हैं, बिकॉज द हार्ट इज नॉट वर्किंग, इट विल कॉज पल्मरी एडिमा. बट वेन एवर इट इज सेप्टिक शॉक, द फर्स्ट थिंग इन सेप्टिक शॉक और हाइपोवोलेमिक शॉक इज गिव अ बोलस ऑफ फ्लूइड्स मैन. दैट बोलस ऑफ फ्लूइड्स विल डेफिनेटली कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू एटलीस्ट पेरिफेरल पल्सेस कमिंग बैक, सो दैट यू आर एबल टू एंश्योर परफ्यूजन ऑफ द किडनीज, यू आर एबल टू एंश्योर परफ्यूजन ऑफ द ब्रेन. अदरवाइज तो मल्टी ऑर्गन डिस्फंक्शन स्टार्ट हो जाएगा ना यार उसको. So the point to be remembered is we will be starting in this chap normal saline. That's the correct answer for this one. Though all options are looking fine, कि भाई एंटीबायोटिक भी देना ही है, भाई सेप्टिक शॉक है, इन्फेक्शन है ना, तो एंटीबायोटिक भी देना है, राइट? नो डाउट अबाउट इट. आई मीन, आई माइट हैव टू स्टार्ट मीरोपेनेम इन द पेशेंट, आई माइट बी स्टार्टिंग पिपरासिलिन टैजोबैक्टम इन द पेशेंट एज वी नॉर्मली डू. वी ट्राई टू गिव कवरेज फॉर बोथ ग्राम पॉजिटिव एंड ग्राम नेगेटिव ऑर्गेनिजम्स, बट द पॉइंट इज गाइज, फ्लूइड रेसुसिटेशन इज द फर्स्ट थिंग. सो ऑल ऑफ दीज वुड बी डन. बट उसने सवाल क्या पूछा था? क्वेश्चन लैंग्वेज वॉज वट इज द फर्स्ट स्टेप. सो यू नीड टू जस्ट आइडेंटिफाई वी आर ट्रीटिंग अ चैप विद शॉक. So I'm gonna give IV fluids to the patient. Now, after IV fluids, what I'm gonna do subsequently? So I'll just put numbers there. This is the first thing that I'll be doing in this patient. Subsequently, I will do add vasopressors as well, because alone fluids will not work. I'll obviously give broad spectrum antibiotics to the patient, and subsequently, if person is not responding to these three, then he says even give hydrocortisone shot. Though hydrocortisone is primarily because it's gonna increase cortisol in the body, and you very well know cortisol is the stress hormone in the body, no? So you are helping the body tide over the stress. So for those of you who answered Bombay, that was initially coming up in the chat, I want you guys to understand the fact that hydrocortisone is given just because you want to ensure that this chap's body is able to handle the stress component. That's it. I mean, there's no other role of hydrocortisone. But hydrocortisone is given even in status asthmaticus. Why? Because there it is going to reduce the production, inhibit the production of leukotrienes. Hydrocortisone is given in Addisonian crisis, because that's where, Addisonian crisis is a pure endocrinological emergency. So hydrocortisone is used a lot of time in the casualty. I told you status asthmaticus, I said endocrine emergencies, even in myxedema coma, we will be using it. Addisonian crisis, we guys are going to be using it. But here it's mainly to help the patient tide over the crisis. That's a backup that you would be using. I mean, the steps are give fluid resuscitation, use vasopressors, and then subsequently, absolutely, that's the next step that would come up. In case in this MCQ I had modified this saying that the person is suffering from warm shock. You very well know that in all patients of septic shock, initially warm shock hota, bounding pulses hoti. This is itself a question of your exam. Which shock would be having bounding pulses and increased cardiac output? It is warm shock, which is initial phase of septic shock. And subsequently, obviously, you would be having cold, clammy extremities developing in a patient. That would be cold shock. So quickly, guys, comment here in a chap with warm shock, what is the vasopressor that you would be using? And in cold shock, what would be the vasopressor that you would be using? I'll just improve my handwriting a bit so that it becomes more legible in the PDF subsequently. Yes, guys, waiting for your inputs. I mean, only shock with increased cardiac output is septic shock. Vasopressor of choice. Quickly, guys. waiting. Come on. What are you a little shy in commenting? So many guys in the chat. Warm shock is gonna be norepinephrine. Na yaar, humne discuss kiya na norepinephrine. In fact, ye to maine statement hai, isko dhyan bhi rakhna. What is the vasopressor of choice in septic shock? Answer is not gonna be given by you as dopamine and dobutamine, which in pharma they have to teach you so many drugs, so they talk with begin by discussion by talking about dopamine dobutamine. So the impression in everybody's mind is ki bhi dopamine dobutamine are the first line vasopressors always. No, man, in septic shock and in cardiogenic shock, I'll not go into at the moment, that will complicate things. It is norepinephrine which is the preferred vasopressor. And in cold shock you will be using epinephrine. If you don't have that, you can obviously be using even phenylephrine for the patient. Good job, Dr. Aishwarya and Dr. Nisha Akshay, you came up with good answers in this case. So we are sorted with this question. The answer to this one is delta. Do remember, whenever you read about shock, forget about cardiogenic shock. You obviously have to give a fluid bolus to the patient initially. Good attempt by everybody. And I had a mixed runner. You marathon running would be 42 kilometers, right? And this chap, he falls down with cramps and abdominal pain and is not able to complete the race, and he's brought to the hospital. Now in the casualty, he has developed convulsions as well. So you need to pick up electrolyte imbalance, which is contributing to the manifestations of convulsion in this case. I had varied responses coming up again for this one. Okay, fine. I hope that background thing is taken care of. Okay, very good. Okay, A also coming up. So, pehli baat to yaar dekho, hypocalcemia will contribute to tetanino. And hypocalcemia is what you usually seen after, is commonly seen after thyroid surgery. So, I think that option number A should definitely not be thought of. A marathon runner is going to be having loss of lot of electrolytes from the body, is going to sweat a lot. Because of this excessive sweating, is going to lose water from the body, is going to lose sodium from the body. So, I mean, any chap who's doing a lot of physical activity would anyway be having electrolyte imbalance. The sodium values will definitely start falling in the chap. And hyponatremia, if the sodium values in the patient go down to less than 125 milliequivalent, you very well know the normal 135 to 145, the patient can definitely end up with the distinct possibility of even seizures. I'm still having B coming up in the chat because you see, I understand hypokalemia can also come up, but hypokalemia will mainly contribute to muscle weakness. It will contribute to muscle cramps, agreed, but it will not contribute to seizures. The reason why in this multiple choice question I highlighted the word convulsions is mainly to point to the fact that whenever you read about hypokalemia, you don't read about convulsions occurring in a patient. I mean, why does hypokalemia kill a man? Then hypokalemia can kill a man due to diaphragmatic paralysis. The correct answer for this would be option number delta, hyponatremia. And since I've had B coming up in the options here, I want to highlight that again, because you guys made an error, go through the electrolyte discussion once again. I have given an example, EC type ka question hai, right? I've explained this particular scenario. In fact, this happened with an Indian athlete. Now, I don't want to get into that, what happened with an Indian athlete when she went abroad for a marathon running and the Indian coach was not available at that point of time. But the point is, most of these athletes, when they run, they sweat a lot and they keep on drinking large amount of water. They should ideally be drinking those special fluids that come, Gatorade or those sports related drinks, because they contain both electrolytes as well as water. But most of these people, if they consume only water, there will be a hyponatremia that would be coming up, and that can contribute to definitive problems. In fact, for marathon running, I want to tell you that these patients do not have hypovolemic. Why not hypovolemic? Because while they're running, they're served water in between. So they keep on drinking water in between. So it is actually a euvolemic hyponatremia that can be seen. It's a hot favorite of the examiners that they love to ask regarding, I would say, hypovolemic, euvolemic and hypernatremic hypovolemia. And marathon running or endurance sports is what I've highlighted. E is endurance sports, E, and that would be E again for a euvolemic hyponatremia. Yes, it's a dilutional component that comes up, but the bottom line is, I mean, any chap who is doing a lot of physical activity, there would definitely be water depletion. I've written water depletion, but then this water supplements are also given. I mean, this is a common problem with most athletes, that they are not taking those energy drinks. And by energy drinks, I mean that they also contain some amount of carbohydrates so that they are able to metabolize that while they're on the way to the finish line. The answer to this question is option number delta. Please read the hyponatremia aspect once again. In fact, electrolytes mein jo sabse common puchta hai, wo hyponatremia puchta hai. Uske baad mein hypokalemia. Excess ki jagah pe deficiency, because we have this tendency to read more and he usually asks you about what is relatively lesser. So the message here is, any guy who's having excessive physical work, it could be a laborer in a hot Indian summer, it could be a marathon runner, they end up with hyponatremia. That's the bottom line. And convulsions are definitely seen if the sodium values would come down. Okay, Ashok says, what about hypophosphatemia? So, yaar, phosphate ke saath mein pehli baat to marathon running or sweating mein phosphate ki values ko hum dekhte nahi na. Phosphate is something that is regulated mainly by PTH. So, if we are talking about something like a hypophosphatemic rickets, right, then I would have talked about phosphate per se, but phosphate deficiency is not what you read with marathon running per se. In fact, we just need to remember endurance sports would contribute to issues in these patients. Doc, for seizures, as somebody put up, if it is seizures, what we have to do for this chap is give hypertonic saline. Yeah, beer port ammonia is also given in the notes. That's the Australian way of living, no? They get up in the morning and they drink beer. So compulsive beer drinking se bhi ye ho sakta hai. So Dr. Ashok, I hope that query of yours is satisfied. Phosphate ko aapne hamesha PTH ke saath mein relate karna hai. Rickets ke saath mein relate karna hai, and not with respect to marathon running. And because this guy is having seizures, so primarily for any chap having hyponatremia with seizures, a correction has to be given. And I've also explained ki correction mein sodium kitna badhana hai, to seedha normal nahi kar dena. 120 से 140 नहीं करते, करेक्शन जो होता है उसमें डेली 8 मिलीक्वेलेंट इंक्रीज करना होता है, 120 से 128, फ्रॉम 128 टू 136. सो इंक्रीज पर डे इज इन 8 मिलीक्वेलेंट्स. टोटल डेफिसिट इज ऑब्वियसली आई वांट टू इंक्रीज फ्रॉम 120 टू 140. सो इफ ही सेज इन अ पेशेंट विद हाइपोनेट्रीमिया टोटल कितना करोगे, तो इंक्रीज विल बी फ्रॉम 120 टू 140. देयर इज अ फार्मूला व्हिच इज यू नो गिवन इन द ऐप, यू कैन गो थ्रू दैट. आई एम नॉट डिस्कसिंग द फार्मूला एट द मोमेंट, और आई विल जस्ट राइट इट डाउन. आई मीन टोटल बॉडी वाटर multiplied by desired value minus the actual value. So our total body water, how do we calculate? So that depends on, you know, gender being male or female. If the gender is gonna be male, the multiplication factor would be 0.6 for weight, and for female it would be 0.5 into weight. The bottom line is, I mean, if he says what is the total deficit, then the desired value is 140. And if he says correction per day, then correction per day would be, I mean, from 120 I would upgrade to 128, then 120 to 136, like that, and sudden increase would contribute to osmotic demyelination syndrome. Okay, G. So answer to this question is delta. Let's move on to the eighth one for today. The question says steppage gait would be seen with which of the following? A quick input from you guys. Yes, would be appreciated. Okay. Okay, Rahul says frontal lobe stroke. So frontal lobe stroke mein toh what you have is a magnetic gait, no? And is magnetic gait and high steppage gait the same? Then I don't think so. They are not the same. I had syringomyelia coming up for a Rishi for hyperventilation. There will be respiratory alcohol losses. For people mentioning syringomyelia, yeah, syringomyelia ki presentation kya hoti hai? Syringomyelia will be causing an expansion of the central canal, na? And that expansion of the central canal will press on the lateral spinothalamic pathway, and spinothalamic pathway carries what? Pain and temperature. So the presentation of syringomyelia will be painless burn in the hand, like this person would be cooking food for himself, like he is a student, he is making an omelette for himself, his hand accidentally touches the hot plate, he gets a first degree burn, but still it does not hurt. For people who saying D, Parkinsonism, what is the gait that I said, ma'am? Parkinsonism, he will be having a particular, you know, stooped posture, arms that would be slightly flexed, and when he walks he will be taking short shuffling steps. That's the technical term that you use, that is called as fascinating gait, na? Guys, you have to solve questions by exclusion. It's not that everything can be served on a platter. You guys are definitely gonna be able to rule out A and D the moment you read this question, because frontal lobe is magnetic gait. Parkinsonism is fascinating gait. Steppage gait ka matlab kya hota? Let me just show you an image. I mean, though it's slightly blurred, but what's happening in this chap is that there's a very characteristic. I mean, if I just recreate what is happening here, though it's drawn, there is a very characteristic foot drop in the patient. You see, the dorsiflexion of the ankle is not possible. So this particular chap, the toes will be touching the ground. Now the image is a little blurred, so I agree to that fact. So therefore I put a animation before it, or I would say a diagram before it. But I want to highlight this fact that any chap who's having a foot drop, you see, in you and me the heel touches the ground. In this guy, the toes will be touching the ground. So you call it a steppage gait, or sometimes it would be called as a slapping gait also. You need a foot drop for it. And when do you get a foot drop? You get it with patients of peripheral neuropathy. It could be diabetics, it could be leprosy. Yes, Javed, you are spot on for this one. Mani, you are spot on for this one. Absolutely, Hazra, Dr. Hazra, peripheral neuropathy. The correct answer for question number 8 is Bombay. And I would request you to, when you solve questions, not all questions in the exam would be direct ones. It's a mixed bag. So I have put a combination in today's discussion, just to, you know, get the just to tell you that some of them are gonna be recall based, but a lot of them would be based on exclusion also. Answer to question number 8 is Bombay. I hope we are sorted, guys. Option A, I repeat once again, is gonna be magnetic gait. The guy is gonna be literally with feet stuck to the ground. Parkinsonism people, they would be walking like this. You see, stoop posture. Like when you and me walk, there is a little bit of flexion at the knee joint, no? Like when you and me walk, if I show a walking for you and me, there would be some movement definitely happening at the knee joint, at the ankle joint, because our muscles are coordinating activity. And we walk straight, and we all have is a automatic arm swing. When we walk, we don't realize, but we all have an automatic arm swing. A Parkinsonism chap, when he walks, there will be no automatic arm swing. When he will walk, you will hear the soles of the shoes of this guy rubbing against the ground. It would be short shuffling steps. If you place a obstacle, like a child kicked a football in front of grandfather who's suffering from Parkinsonism, if the grandfather will try to kick the football, he might actually fall. If he tries to jump over this football, you know, if he tries to, you know, try and demonstrate some kind of a skill with football, the grandfather is gonna fall. You will have a stooped posture. You would have a reduced automatic arm swing. That's the meaning of the word fascinating gait. So you should be able to work out the aspects which I've highlighted here. I mean, the word is, okay, somebody mentioned in the chat, doc, it's tapes dorsalis. I think autocorrection put it rabies dorsalis. It's tapes dorsalis actually. स्टेपेज गेट का मतलब यही हुआ ना यार कि उसका जो फुट है फुट ड्रॉप प्रेजेंट है ना स्टेपेज गेट और हाई स्टेपेज गेट दैट इज ही इज गोना लिफ्ट हिज फुट अप ये वाला इमेज देखो स्टेपेज वुड मीन दैट व्हेन ही इज गोना वॉक इट्स नॉट गोना बी नॉर्मल वॉक लाइक दिस द टोज आर गोना बी यू नो द टोज आर गोना बी टचिंग द ग्राउंड एंड okay fine if some rapsters are guys who do rapping if they have this kind of a gait I'm not very sure but otherwise for us it's always pathological Muhammad Ali had Parkinsonism right that was fascinating it okay chaps we are sorted for this one answer to question number 8 is option number C and do try to work out the exclusions also I mean syringomyelia we read with respect to painless burn in the hand that's pressure on the lateral spinothalamic pathway which carries pain and temperature sensation so two sensations are affected simultaneously okay let's move to the ninth one The question says which of the following is not included in the triad of Parkinsonism. So I think that's a relatively easier one. Quick answers expected here. Yes, guys. Thanks, Dr. Ahmed. Regards from India. Yes, guys. Waiting for you guys to comment quickly. Parkinsonism. You would definitely be having pin rolling tremors, no? So this is definitely on. I already spoke about fascinating gait. The chances of falling will definitely be higher. Yes, and absolutely, guys, you're getting it spot on. In any patient, I mean, you do get fascinating gait, but that fascinating gait is not included in the triad per se. The mnemonic I've said is TBR. That would be tremors. That would be bradykinesia. That would be rigidity. Fascinating gait is a feature, but then that's not included in the triad per se. I mean, remember that aspect. Tapes dorsalis, somebody mentioned, you see tapes dorsalis, mein dorsal column is also affected. Na? So the proprioception part is affected. And proprioception means joint and position sense. So if you can't feel your foot touching the ground, like at the moment, if you are listening to me, like maybe you might be sitting on a chair or you would be, you know, lounging in your bed comfortably and listening to me. But your foot, if it is touching some surface, you can at least feel no that your foot is touching the bed sheet or is touching the ground per se. Now in a chap with tapes dorsalis, because this query came up, if a chap is having tapes dorsalis, he would not be able to have joint and position sense. So if you really cannot feel your feet touching the ground, then you might get a feel as if you might fall. So when you walk, the walk would definitely be different from the way a normal person would walk. And that again is what is referred as a steppage gait. In fact, for tapes dorsalis, because you put up, I'll say like this, the guy will lift his foot off the ground and press it hard onto the ground because pressure, I said joint and position sense, but when you press foot hard on the ground, then pressure would come up, no? So it would let you know that your foot is touching the ground. So, I mean, that's the explanation I can give. Like this guy, he lifts his foot off the ground, presses it hard so that at least he knows that foot is touching the ground. That's tapes dorsalis explaining the steppage gait component. Answer to question number 9 is Bombay. That was fascinating gait is not a feature. It's a feature, but it's not included in the triad per se. So two triads in neurology are commonly asked. I've asked both of them today. Normal pressure hydrocephalus, which will come up in the discussion subsequently. And right now I've spoken about fascinating gait. Okay, cool. 9 is Bombay. Somebody still commented D. Rigidity, you know, for upper limb we use the word cogwheel and for the lower limb alphabet L can be used to remember lead pipe rigidity. So L for lower limb, L for lead pipe, upper limb would be cogwheel rigidity. Answer to 9 is Bombay. Let's move to the 10th one. So this guy is a big time boozer. He loves drinking alcohol and he has ended up with currently abdominal distension and difficulty in lying in prone position because this alcoholic patient is presented with ascites. The question says which of the following derangements would be commonly seen in any patient with ascites. I had quick inputs from a couple of guys. Remaining people can also, you know, let me know here. Yes, guys. You see, in any patient with ascites, effectively the circulating fluid volume will be lesser. The point is, ascites is a patient of ascites is a situation of third space loss. Ascites is a condition in which there is redistribution of fluid. So this redistribution of fluid will contribute to, I repeat the fact again, this redistribution of fluid will contribute to, because the fluid is wasted in the peritoneal cavity, the blood supply to the kidney will be lesser. And if you decrease the blood supply to the kidney, the RAS system will be activated, and this would contribute to increase of aldosterone. And I think everybody has got this question right, because you very well know the action of aldosterone on the epithelial sodium channel. What aldosterone is gonna do is it's gonna draw in salt and water, but at the same time it's gonna kick out potassium and hydrogen. And when I say I kick out hydrogen from the body, it would contribute to metabolic alkalosis. A good job by everybody. The bottom line is, every time you would be having a chap who is having ascites, these patients would be having metabolic alkalosis. And in all of these patients, because there's more salt and water coming in, so that's the reason why you always explain these chaps to go in for a salt restricted diet. And you also put these guys on aldosterone antagonist, that is spironolactone. And if these guys are not gonna follow your advice, then they can develop a complication also, that is called as hepatorenal syndrome. So there's a possibility that in the exam, if he says what is the problem with person who's having ascites, then it's metabolic alkalosis. Lekin if the same chap will not follow your advice, he's not doing salt restriction, he's not taking spironolactone, the ascites component will keep on increasing, then these patients can be having a hepatorenal syndrome. And if the kidney will fail, then the same chap will go into metabolic acidosis. Please remember the fact that whenever a chap is having hepatorenal syndrome, it's a pre-renal variety of acute kidney injury for which you will have to give specific management. Quickly comment in the chat box. Doc, there is no mention of any respiratory distress in the question at the moment. Why not acidosis due to lactic acid accumulation? Well, there's no septic shock happening at the moment or shock happening in this chap, right? So, I mean, if I said there is a circulatory failure, then agreed, lactic acidosis would have come up. Waiting in the comment box, please mention regarding what is the drug that you use for treatment of hepatorenal syndrome. Dr. Balara, I could not get your point. Alcoholic patients, liver failure, ascites. Yep. Okay, Dr. Balara, you have to rephrase your question. Quickly comment on the chat box, guys. Treatment for hepatorenal syndrome, kya dete hain? Albumin is given. Okay, fine. Albumin, what else? सर हिपाटोरिनल सिंड्रोम में किडनी इंजरी है ना, सो यू नीड टू एंश्योर ब्लड सप्लाई टू द किडनी. तो क्या यूज करते हैं? यू कैन यूज टू मॉलिक्यूल्स, इधर ऑक्ट्रोटाइड और यू कैन बी यूजिंग मिडोड्रेन. सो फॉर ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ हिपाटोरिनल सिंड्रोम इट इज मिडोड्रेन एंड ऑक्ट्रोटाइड. फॉर ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ असाइटिस इट इज स्पर्नोलैक्टोन. फिर से रिपीट कर देता हूँ. एनी चैप हु इज हैविंग असाइटिस एंड ही सेज क्या करोगे, मैसिव असाइटिस की बात नहीं कर रहा, फॉर दैट यू नीड टू गो फॉर लार्ज वॉल्यूम पैरासेंटिसिस. You need to remove that fluid. If it's gonna be like 5 liters of fluid present, I will go for a large volume paracentesis. What I am talking about is plain ascites, I'll be giving spironolactone. अगर वो चेंज कर देता है, सेम चैप इज हैविंग डिक्रीज यूरिन आउटपुट, तो फिर किडनी फेल हो जाएगी, तो इट विल कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू मेटाबॉलिक एसिडोसिस. एंड फॉर हिपाटोरिनल सिंड्रोम वी विल बी गिविंग फॉर दीज पेशेंट्स मिडोड्रेन एंड ऑक्ट्रेट्राइड. आंसर टू दिस क्वेश्चन इज बॉम्बे. लेट्स मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट वन. Doc, I can't specify for any exam. It's just that the discussion has to be remembered. Okay, cool. Let's move on to the next one. Javed, you were spot on in mentioning octreotide. I mean, that's what we standard use in portal hypertension. I have a 50-year-old chap who feels extremely weak at the end of the day, and the weakness resolves with rest. So, what the first line of the MCQ is telling you is diurnal variation in the weakness. In any MCQ in neurology, if you read about diurnal weakness or diurnal variation of weakness, you obviously think in terms of either myasthenia gravis or Lambert-Eaton syndrome. So let's read what the question says subsequently. This chap is having asymmetrical ptosis, so that helps you in identifying that this is myasthenia gravis. Myasthenia gravis is more common in women. But even in young women, it is common. But in males, it is usually common between 50 to 60 years of age. So in those circumstances, I mean, I want you to remember the fact that whenever you read about diurnal variation, you read about the asymmetrical ptosis and the voice becoming weak on continuous speaking. Like, I'm going to speak here before you for 3 hours. So in the first minute and in the last minute of this entire three and a half hour discussion, my voice is going to be having the same pitch and the same timbre. But in this chap, because of the weakness of the vocal cords, the diagnosis of this patient is kept as myasthenia gravis. And the question says, which of the following is correct about this particular condition? Okay, fine. I think most guys have got it spot on, but then we'll just work it out. Option A says deep tendon reflexes will be preserved. I'm just putting a plus here to say that, okay, this looks like a cool statement or a correct statement, because that's what you get in myasthenia gravis, weakness with normal DTS. I mean, the line that I've highlighted for MG is, though I'm not saying it as the answer at the moment because I've not looked at the remaining options, the standard line for myasthenia gravis is weakness with normal reflexes. So this looks to be the answer. Let's read on. Repetitive nerve stimulation shows an incremental response. That is for Lambert-Eaton syndrome. So B is off the radar. Adrophonium will worsen the weakness of the muscles. Well, when it comes to myasthenia gravis, adrophonium will improve the weakness of the muscles. So that means two things are off the radar right away, B and C. Workup for presence of malignancy. Now, myasthenia gravis is associated with usually autoimmune disorder. Like, myasthenia gravis can be associated with Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Most of the time, MG and autoimmune disorders can coexist in a patient. Option number D, why it is not the answer, is because that is again related to Lambert-Eaton syndrome. We have discussed that it is Hodgkin cell cancer, which could be producing specific antibodies that are called as anti-P/Q antibodies. And what these antibodies are going to do is they're going to act on the neuromuscular junction, and they're going to decrease the acetylcholine production at the neuromuscular junction. So the bottom line is that option B, C and D, if you read the wordings very carefully, all of them are pointing towards Lambert-Eaton per se. I mean, option number C, I'm not saying is per se for Lambert-Eaton. It is just that it is technically wrong, because adrophonium will usually cause an improvement in a patient. The correct answer for this question will be option number alpha. Deep tendon reflexes will be preserved in this chap. And well, the reason behind I mentioned is because it's a post-junctional defect. So still some amount of acetylcholine is present to cause a deep tendon reflex. I mean, that unless and until it is myasthenic crisis. If I said myasthenic crisis, then reflexes would definitely be abolished. But in myasthenia gravis, still the post-junctional defect and the receptor turnover ensures the fact that at least some critical amount of acetylcholine is present to ensure that reflexes to come up, because reflexes will require a certain amount of threshold, so that threshold can definitely be present. C-doc thymoma per se is, I would say, okay, so you mean to say, Aniket had a point there. He said that the last chat that came up, DTRs are not preserved in Lambert-Eaton. They are lesser because acetylcholine is lesser. That was, I'll come to Aniket, your point, in a second. I just want to highlight this fact that in patients of Lambert-Eaton syndrome, you do have a prejunctional defect. The acetylcholine present in the neuromuscular junction is less than the critical threshold required for a development of a deep tendon reflex. But when it comes to myasthenia gravis, the critical amount of acetylcholine is present in that sufficient amount that you would get a reflex generation per se. Then, except for thymoma, Aniket, I mean, apart from thymoma aspect, you know, majority of patients would be having a thymic hyperplasia. So I would say that option number D, I'll put a plus minus, right, to say the fact that this is partially a correct statement, not exactly a correct one, because majority of myasthenia gravis patients are associated with thymic hyperplasia. In fact, that's what I said. 65% of myasthenia gravis patients have a thymic hyperplasia, 10% are having a thymoma. So D really, I would say, would not hold ground, in a sense that I'm not saying that it's a wrong statement, but it is not a perfectly correct statement as well. So in between these two options, you anyway have to select the best answer. The answer to this question is delta. And yes, I agree to, you know, even Rahul put up that D as an answer. But I think my explanation that I gave to Aniket initially has solved this for you. Okay, G. Answer is alpha, guys. Reflexes are always preserved in myasthenia gravis. Reason I've explained. इट्स ओनली अ स्केलेटल मसल डिजीज मायस्थेनिया ग्रेविस. ओके जी, लेट्स मूव टू द 12th वन फॉर टुडे. ट्रेक्युलाइजेशन ऑफ द ईसोफेगस विद फूड इंपैक्शन इज सीन इन विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग. एंड यस, वेरी गुड वेरी गुड. आई एम हैविंग गाइज हु आर वेरी क्विक टू रिस्पॉन्ड नाउ. नो राहुल, नो राहुल. चलो ऐसे पढ़ो ना, आई विल शो अ इमेज देन. आई मीन सिंस कपल ऑफ पीपल हैव मेस्टर्ड अप नाउ. जैसे ट्रेकिया में रिंग्स होते हैं ना, जैसे ट्रेकिया में रिंग्स होते हैं, मतलब वहां तो कार्टिलेजनस रिंग्स होते हैं, वैसे ही ईसोफेगस में भी रिंग्स हैं. कॉरूगेटेड अपीयरेंस प्रेजेंट है ना, बिकॉज ऑफ द कॉरूगेटेड अपीयरेंस देयर वुड बी अ फूड इंपैक्शन अकरिंग इन द गाय. द मूवमेंट आई हैव शोन दिस इमेज एवरीबॉडी हैज गॉट इट स्पॉट ऑन, बट देन दिस दिस कंसेंट्रिक रिंग अपीयरेंस, आई जस्ट जॉट इट डाउन फॉर द कंप्लीशन सेक. आई मीन व्हेन आई राइट द स्टेटमेंट, कंसेंट्रिक रिंग अपीयरेंस ऑफ द ईसोफेगस, that's a very standard thing that is seen with eosinophilic esophagitis. And because of this corrugated, you know, if you have that drain, if you see the drain pipe, you know, below a sink or a wash basin in your house, that drain pipe will be having a corrugated or a irregular appearance, no, similar kind of an appearance. So that's what is classically present, and because of this corrugated appearance or the ring appearance, I am saying the word benign esophagus. Basically, that's another term that is used, but the correct answer for this question is option number Bombay. Since I got A also as an answer, that I want to highlight that Chasky's ring would be at the lower part of the esophagus. So if I was describing a question to you where a person says that he has difficulty in specially eating non-veg food items, but he says that when it comes to semi-solid food, I don't have a problem, and this problem has been persistent for a very long duration. Unlike achalasia cardia, which is an example of progressive dysphagia, if you read a question that begins by saying a non-progressive dysphagia, there is history of meat impaction, or even if meat impaction does not occur, I said specially problem with eating non-vegetarian food. And when you do upper GI endoscopy in the patient, then you are able to see esophageal ring. But this ring that is present, I mean, we don't need to confuse this with upper esophageal web that we read with Plummer-Vinson syndrome. In Plummer-Vinson, the problem is in the upper one third of the esophagus. Here we're talking about lower one third of the esophagus. Then we have to think in terms of Schatzky's ring per se. Yep, has a B ring. So I mean, standard is, or if I include this word, aphagia, that he ate non-veg, like he had a mutton biryani, or uske baad mein he says something is stuck. He can talk, you know. We're not talking about cafe coronary. We're not talking about cafe coronary. I'm talking about meat bolus impacted at the lower one third of the esophagus. Then it is Schatzky's ring, and I mean there could be a distinct possibility of even a perforation occurring in this case. In this patient, pneumomediastinum manifestations will occur. The key word of our question was trachealization of the esophagus, which means that this would be ring appearance present. That is the feature that is seen with eosinophilic esophagitis. The remaining options are anyway dummy, Barrett esophagus, you see it with gastroesophageal reflux disease. Pulsion diverticula would basically be talking about mainly the involvement at the inferior constrictor. It's mainly Zinker diverticulum that he's talking about. But again, Zinker diverticulum is a diverticula. There would not be any, you know, ring appearance present in the esophagus. So 12 is spot on, guys. Answer is Bombay. We move to the subsequent one. The question says, we have this 90-year-old patient who presents with fracture of the femur after a fall and was hospitalized. I mean, a pretty senior citizen fell in the bathroom, was hospitalized, and day two he is having breathlessness. The question is saying which of the following is a least likely diagnosis. So we are not talking about a scenario of what's commonly going to happen, because post fracture we can have a fat embolism syndrome, we can have an ARDS manifestation, he says, which is unlikely in this patient. So yes guys, quickly for question number 13, and yes, we can see that pattern with GERD as well, Dr. Bibhuti, but it's primarily gonna be answered as eosinophilic esophagitis of feline esophagus. Okay. In any patient who's having respiratory difficulty, we will get a fat embolism definitely on, The person might develop deep vein thrombosis within 48 to 72 hours, and then this clot in the soleal veins will embolize into the pulmonary artery. It could contribute to age patient. Then the senior age patient will obviously be having a high risk of acute coronary syndrome. I mean, at 90 years of age, acute coronary syndrome and myocardial infarction can contribute to pulmonary edema, and that can also explain the breathlessness of the patient. The correct answer for this question is Bombay, that is pulmonary artery hypertension, because this is always a chronic illness. I mean, pulmonary artery hypertension will always be having some preceding history present, no, of breathlessness since a couple of months. Or let me say, if I put up this question like, this guy is an army veteran. This guy retired from the Indian Army and he spent 10 years at Siachen Glacier. So people who spend 10 years at high altitude, they can develop, because of hypoxia long standing, they can develop pulmonary artery hypertension. Or if I gave you a scenario, somebody having a valvular heart disease, especially related to mitral valve. You see, in this age, mostly it is aortic valve that is involved. So aortic valve usually does not contribute to pulmonary, because problem is, you know, on the left ventricle output into the aorta. So most of the time you don't have a pulmonary artery issue coming up. So I would say that problem with the heart valves would always be having a chronic or a long standing history. The correct answer for this question is Bombay. Please appreciate the fact that why I said D will be present is because this is a very old age patient. At 90 years of age, to yaar MI to kabhi bhi ho sakta na. Atherosclerosis hota hai, calcification develops in the coronary arteries, aur wo jo calcified plaques hain, agar wo calcified plaque tear ho jaye. You know, you read about plaque fissure. So if there's a calcified atherosclerotic plaque and it tears, then there could be a thrombus formation, and that could again explain why in this chap, I mean, myocardial infarction could be occurring. Doctor, it's a range actually. See, you cannot say that if respiratory distress has occurred after 48 hours, it's unlikely to be fat embolism. That duration is an average duration. Dr. Saranya had put up that point in GERD criteria, that manifestations will occur after 72 hours. That is not something which will decide. It's the presence of the criteria. Okay, this event occurs after these many hours, it's just an average value, but that's not an absolute value. Like, suppose I say ventricular tachycardia is common after 12 hours of MI, that does not mean that ventricular tachycardia will occur only after 12 hours. No, it can occur in the first hour itself, and person may never reach the hospital. So I mean, the duration is a hint towards rule out a diagnosis. The bottom line in this question is fat embolism, pulmonary embolism, they're anyway related to immobilization, and especially after orthopedic issues, fat embolism is common. Considering the extreme age group of the patient, MI can also occur, but pulmonary artery hypertension occurs primarily with a long standing history. Answer to this question is Bombay. Okay, I still had, you know, couple of inputs coming as C also. So sir, point is, no, if somebody can't walk, if he's completely bedridden, in old age patients, there can be development of deep vein thrombosis, no, that is soleal veins can be having clot formation, and then this clot will fragment, and those pieces of clots will travel retrogradely via the inferior vena cava into, there will be a serious VP mismatch, or ventricular perfusion mismatch in the patient. 13 I think was an easy one, guys. I mean, I don't expect this kind of a question to ever go wrong. I think it's a straightforward one. Let's move to the 14th. I mean, 13 is okay. He says, which of the following is the most likely one? Because it's an ortho, I'll consider that as the first possibility of fat embolism syndrome. Then would be fat embolism. Rahul, I've already answered that. Pulmonary embolism, yes, I'll do a CT chest, no? That can definitely help me, because if I see a embolus, if I see a contrast, if I see a hypodensity in the pulmonary artery, which is not allowing the contrast to go forward, it is pulmonary embolism. I embolism, well, nothing much would be done apart from giving heparin to the patient. Okay, so I understand when everybody was reading about question number 13, they were of the impression that I've asked the common diagnosis, but do read it carefully. I did not say what is the possible diagnosis. I said which of the following is unlikely to be a diagnosis. So that words do matter, man. I mean, I think a lot of chaps who answered initially, they fell for the trap and they did not even read the word least likely. They said fat embolism primarily. Okay, so I hope, Rahul, your query sorted. Moving to the next one. A young lady has panic attacks whenever she is in a public place and she starts hyperventilating. Which of the following is correct about this presentation? I'm not very sure, Dr. Sharma, whether this was. Okay, maybe. Okay, let's move on. Moving to question number 14, a young lady is having panic attacks whenever she is in a public place, and I mean anytime if she is having panic attacks, she will start hyperventilating, and he says which is correct about this presentation. So I can have quick answer to this question. Yes guys, I'm ruling out option number one because multiple sclerosis is the one which is usually related to optic neuritis, which is related to blindness. So option number A is off the radar, unlikely to be a diagnosis of this case. Transient ischemic attack will usually cause neurological manifestations like aphasia, or it will contribute to arm weakness. It would cause slurring of the voice. So that is why I'm ruling out option number Bombay also. I'm left with multi vitamin deficiency and respiratory alcohol. It will cause a carbon dioxide washout, and that will contribute to respiratory alkalosis in a patient. And yeah, I mean, in future, these patients can even have redistribution of calcium, and that redistribution of calcium can contribute to tetany also. And yes, somebody put up beautifully that we will use a paper bag for management of these patients as well. I'll just check at my end the internet part. Okay guys, I think I will be able to resolve this. Okay. Okay, I'll just wait for a while for the network to settle down. I think it should settle. Yeah, maybe because of the rainfall. Yes, yes, I will connect to the suggested connections. Okay, fine guys. I hope you can give me a thumbs up if it is fine and you are able to hear me. It's just a transient drop, and if I switch the connection, then there's a distinct possibility that we will lose the stream. Okay, fine. So yes, I'm waiting for you guys to give me a thumbs up. ठीक है यार, वहां देख लो यार, पता नहीं कोई नेटवर्क इशू हो सकता है. प्रखर, उस पे स्विच ऑफ कर लेना इफ इट इज कॉजिंग इश्यूज ना, तो जस्ट स्विच ऑन टू द ऑल्टरनेटिव चैनल. ओके, so it's maybe guys, it's slightly raining, not it's just a drizzle at my place, so I don't think so that even that would be causing too many issues, but let's just sort this one out. Okay, yes Dr. Mihira, I'll definitely try to continue with the SS ones as well. Thanks for joining the discussion. Guys, the correct answer for question number 14 is delta. I mean, the bottom line is whenever you read about hypoventilation, it will always cause a carbon dioxide retention in the patient that will contribute to respiratory acidosis. Whereas whenever it's going to be hyperventilation, it's going to be respiratory alkalosis in a patient. And most of the time in the exam, the scenarios that they give you is either status asthmaticus or they give you Guillain-Barré syndrome for respiratory acidosis. And most of the time in respiratory alkalosis, they'll talk about things like high altitude, or they'll talk about anxiety, or they'll talk about hysteria. I mean, whenever you are, you know, having a question that's beginning with this, then you should be able to figure out the common aspects that they love to ask. Okay, fine. So hopefully things are back on track, guys. You can keep on commenting in the chat box also. Answer to question number 14 is delta. I've just highlighted the standard statement for those of you who just missed out a bit. What I was saying was whenever you have carbon dioxide retention, two standard examples, diaphragmatic failure due to any neurological reason. And at the same time, if there's going to be decrease in carbon dioxide values, then it's going to be, you know, respiratory alkalosis. Yes, doctor, I'll definitely enjoy the chai and samosa. Doctors love chai samosa. You know, doctors hamesha doctors ki party mein fried food hamesha hota hai. Sabko mana karte hai. Chalo ji, answer to 14 is delta. Let's move on. We go to 15. Which of the following is not gonna be seen in a chap who's brain dead? Again, the word not is not to be missed, and let's look at the options. Absent oculocephalic reflexes. The bottom line is, if I turn my head to right, I can turn my eyes to left. You know, main apna head right mein turn karunga, eyes can go to left. If I turn my head to left, I can turn my eyes to right, vice versa. So our eyes can move independently of the position of our head. I repeat the fact, our eyes can move independently of the position of the head. But in a brain dead person, we are going to be having the patient looking spot on. So absent oculocephalic reflexes definitely makes sense in a brain dead person, primarily because this reflex is ensuring stabilization. It helps you to maintain visual fixation. Like, even if you're turning, you can continuously look at a moving object as well. Presence of spinal reflexes. Lots of time when you elicit a deep tendon reflex in a brain dead person, the family member will say, sir, I could see a movement. Because for a non-medico, brain dead means that person will not have any physical movement. But please remember the fact that spinal reflexes can definitely be present. Spinal reflexes can be present in a brain dead person, because the meaning of the word brain dead is mainly it is the brain stem that is hampered. So the message is, in a chap who's having brainstem death, still local spinal reflexes, because spinal cord is still alive. I repeat the fact, spinal cord is still alive. So present spinal reflexes would be present. Now, because the pre-Botzinger complex, which is present in the medulla, which is the pacemaker of the respiratory center, is smashed, it is knocked out. So there would be absence of spontaneous breathing. So if you rule out the options, the correct answer for this question would be option number C, pinpoint pupils. In fact, what you get in a brain dead patient would be fixed non-reactive pupils to light. And meanwhile, just quickly, in any brain dead person, you also check for gag reflex and you check for the cough reflex. Can you quickly tell me in the chat box the root value of the cough reflex? Quickly, guys, can you comment upon the root value for the cough reflex? Gag reflex, I'll ask subsequently. I'm just waiting for inputs from you guys. Root value for cough reflex. And yes, before I mention the cough reflex, yes. Yes. I'm just waiting for some other people to comment here as well. Okay. I knew this error would come up. So do remember, for cough reflex, the root value is going to be 10 and 10. It is not 9 and 10. For gag reflex, it is 9 and 10. In gag reflex, you will use a wooden spatula and you would tickle the back of the throat of the patient and you would be able to figure it out. And in cough reflex, you will, if suppose this is a brain dead person, is intubated, So what you are gonna do is you're gonna send in a guide wire, or you are gonna send in a suction catheter, in fact, not a guide wire, a suction catheter, and the suction catheter will be sent in via the endotracheal tube to touch the carina. Now, once the catheter goes up to the carina, it irritates the trachea that's innervated by the vagus, so that's when the cough reflex is initiated. So the method of elicitation of cough reflex is different from method of elicitation of gag reflex. In gag reflex, it is the posterior pharyngeal wall that is stimulated. In cough reflex, it is the carina that is stimulated with a suction catheter per se. So the root values are different. It is 10 on 10 and 9 and 10 respectively. Okay, good job. Answer 215 is option number Calcutta. Let's move to the next one for today. A 30-year-old lady is suffering with progressive dysphagia, and her physician has diagnosed her with achalasiocardia. He has given you the diagnosis himself, and he says which of the following is correct about this condition. So this time there is nothing like a not or except which is present. Now, when you are gonna evaluate the patient, achalasiocardia, yes guys, waiting for comments from you guys. And while I read, it takes me something like 20-25 seconds, and in the actual exam you have about a 1 minute time to answer. Okay, I had B coming up right away here. Increase in the tone of the cricopharyngeal sphincter, decrease tone of the lower esophageal sphincter. Okay, yes, more people, let's work it out. Loss of inhibitory ganglia in the Meissner plexus. Read carefully. Where is Meissner plexus located and where is Myentric plexus located? Meissner is just submucosal. In patients who are suffering from achalasiocardia, why A is not the answer is because of the fact that the problem lies in the Auerbach plexus. Please read the anatomy once again. It is not A, guys. It is not A because it is gonna be the Myentric plexus that is involved, and it's not the Meissner plexus that is involved. So option number A is definitely ruled out. No, guys, I want to repeat this fact once again. In achalasiocardia, the primary problem in the patient is not in the Meissner's plexus, it is Myentric plexus. B says increase in the tone of the cricopharyngeal sphincter. I think all of you remember that because inhibitory tone is removed or inhibitory control is gone, the increase in tone is of the lower esophageal sphincter. तभी तो खाना नीचे नहीं जाता ना यार. In patient of achalasiocardia, the food is stuck in the lower part of the esophagus because there is increase in the tone of the sphincter. The normal tone of the sphincter is something in the range of about 15 to 25. Here the tone can be increased up to 40 millimeters of mercury or maybe even higher. ऑप्शन नंबर सी जो आप लोग बोल रहे थे दैट वाज वेरी केयरलेस रीडिंग ऑन योर पार्ट. डिक्रीज्ड टोन ऑफ द लोअर इसोफेजियल स्फिंक्टर, वो तो GERD होता है भाई. एच लेजे कार्डिया में GERD थोड़ी ना होता है. एच लेजे कार्डिया में तो स्फिंक्टर का टोन इंक्रीज होता है. द नंबर वन कॉज फॉर एच एलेज कार्डिया इज इट इज ऑटो इम्यून एटियोलॉजी. द करेक्ट आंसर टू दिस इज डेल्टा. मोस्ट ऑफ यू मिस दिस क्वेश्चन प्राइमरली बिकॉज ऑफ केयरलेस रीडिंग. प्लीज रीड द ऑप्शन केयरफुली गाइज, दैट्स वॉट मैटर्स. ऑल ऑफ यू हैव रेड एच एलेज कार्डिया अपटींथ नंबर ऑफ टाइम्स इन योर करियर. इट्स नॉट दैट आई हैव टॉट यू एच एल एज ए कार्डिया, यू ऑल हैव रेड इट राइट फ्रॉम थर्ड ईयर ऑनवर्ड्स. वेन एवर समबडी पिक्स अप सर्जरी बुक और मेडिसिन बुक, हम GI खोलते हैं. And when we read GI, we first topic in the esophagus we read is achalasiocardia, and if we mess up on that, it contributes to a lot of I would say distress also. But then you have to learn to read the words very carefully because they make all the difference, right? I say that words once again, it's the words that make all the difference. So spend time, take a deep breath, get that habit, right? Control your breathing. Read a question with focus. Read the options carefully. See, are those words matching with what your memory is telling you? Don't go only with gut instinct, right? That's what I said. Don't go only with gut instinct. There's a feed coming from my heart. There's a feed coming from the brain. First impression is always the best one. So obviously, do what your heart tells you. That's okay. But then reading the words is definitely important. Okay. Fine. Answer to question number 16 is delta. I hope majority guys missed it, in fact, right? That was some guys got it also. Good, you guys got it. But then the words have to be read very carefully as I've highlighted here. No, Rahul, as I mentioned, it's not Bombay. It's gonna be Delta. Why? Because it's not the cricopharyngeal tone that is increased. HLS cardia would be affecting the lower part of the esophagus. No, that's why the answer is Delta. Yes, the instincts need to be allied. Let's move on to the next one. An old man has been diagnosed as suffering from CLL, and as all relatives would come to you flocking and will say, "Sir, why or how can this person die?" So, yes, Saket, you are perfectly fine. That's a very important phrase, and people who get burnt in the actual exam can relate to that better. That eyes start evaluating, you know. But then at the same time, you need to fine-tune your reflexes. Okay, let's move on to 17. What is the leading cause of death in CLL? I think it's a one-liner question which has slightly been modified. Dr. Strange, I've already answered in the comments earlier. So you very well know that in CLL, it is immunochallenged cells, right? The basic point is it is immature cells which are present in blood cancer, no? And when I say immature cells, they don't know how to differentiate between self and non-self. So you usually read about autoimmune hemolytic anemia. You always read about autoimmune thrombocytopenia. I mean, the immature cells in CLL start attacking self RBC, self platelets, and at the same time, there would also be, because they are immature, so they don't know how to fight against an infection. So therefore, it is sepsis and septic shock that would occur in the patient. It's a one-liner question that is taught in pathology and medicine. The leading cause of death in a person of CLL is infection. It is just modified here slightly that what is the leading cause primarily. Answer to this particular question is option number Delta. True, Rahul. Slightly difficult ones. I had to do that. Okay. Yes, Pramod. I had to do that. Make you study. If you will get super confident and you say I know everything, तो फिर तो यार गलत हो जाएगा ना. फिर पढ़ना छोड़ दोगे, पार्टी करोगे, सिलेक्ट सिटी दिल्ली में हो, सिलेक्ट सिटी वॉक में जाके पार्टी कर रहे हो, है ना. सो आई हैव टू एंश्योर दैट यू रिमेन ग्राउंडेड एंड कीप ऑन स्टडिंग सो दैट यू कीप ऑन इम्प्रूविंग ऑन अ डेली बेसिस. ओके जी, 17 वॉज स्पॉट ऑन, 16 थोड़ा डिफिकल्ट था. 18 पे आते हैं. अभी रिपीट वाले आएंगे तो सही हो जाएंगे आपके, ठीक है. तो कीप द फोकस ऑन, बिकॉज स्टार्टिंग में थोड़े से न्यू हैं, फिर बीच में थोड़े मिक्सड हैं. सो दैट इज वाई आई मीन यू नो वी वेन वेन सम क्वेश्चन गो रॉन्ग, वी टेन टू लूज फोकस एंड वी से टू हेल्प विद इट, राइट. बट देन ऑन अ रेगुलर बेसिस इफ यू कंटिन्यू विद दिस एक्टिविटी, यू वुड बी एबल टू ओवरकम ऑल द चैलेंजेस. ओके, फाइन फाइन गाइस. द क्वेश्चन टॉक्स अबाउट लो सीरम विटामिन बी ट्वेल्व एंड एलिवेटेड फोलेट लेवल्स. वेरी क्लासिकल वन. आई मीन बी ट्वेल्व इज लेस, दैट मीन्स प्रॉब्लम प्रोबेबली लाइज इन द आइलियम, टर्मिनल आइलियम ऑफ द पेशेंट. बट एट द सेम टाइम फोलेट लेवल्स आर एलिवेटेड. फोलेट इज अब्सॉर्ब फ्रॉम द जेजनम. सो दिस इज अ वेरी पेक्यूलियर कंडीशन दैट वी ऑलवेज रीड. आई मीन नॉर्मली वी रीड इधर बोथ आर लेसर, और इफ समबडी इज लाइक डूइंग हेल्थ सप्लीमेंट्स देन बोथ कैन बी एलिवेटेड. बट टू हैव दिस वेरिएशन, वन यू वेरी वेल नो प्रॉब्लम इज इन द टर्मिनल आइलियम, सो देयरफॉर यू विल पिक अप अ डिजीज ऑफ मैल अब्सॉर्प्शन सिंड्रोम. दैट इज यू विल सिलेक्ट बिटवीन ऑप्शन नंबर बी एंड सी. Why have I ruled out option number A and C? I also want to tell you that where is B12 present in the body, then B12 is also stored in white blood cells. And in all blood cancers, if you will read the literature of chronic myeloid leukemia, the pathologist will also teach you serum vitamin B12 is increased in CML, though he will not say why. I'm telling you why, because it is immature cells store white B12. So in all patients of blood cancer, initially B12 levels are grossly elevated. Between the two options, celiac-sporin bacterial overgrowth syndrome, you very well know celiac-sporin is a disease where mainly it is duodenum that is involved, and then it is jejunum and ileum is less likely to be formed. And then Bhavya came up with the right answer that the bacteria in bacterial overgrowth syndrome synthesize folate products. In bacterial overgrowth syndrome, it is the flora. That's the bacteria that came from the large intestine to the small intestine. Bacterial overgrowth syndrome does not mean that there is overgrowth of bacteria. It means that the large intestinal flora have migrated to the small intestine, and then these flora will synthesize folic acid. which will explain why serum folate levels are grossly elevated. And even if you don't want to get into all of this, you know, jugglery that I'm talking about, or all these aspects that I'm talking about, standard statement to be remembered is, I mean, the only MCQ where you will read this combination, B12 being lesser and folic acid spiking through the roof, is bacterial overgrowth syndrome. Answer to this question is option number C. Good job by most of the people who got this right. We will now move to question number 19. GI is something that most guys are very comfortable with, though you messed up on achalasia cardia, right? But then the subsequent ones, you're getting them spot on. Which of the following is best for diagnosis of small intestinal mucosal disease? Because it's saying best, so obviously I'll first try non-invasive, but then if it requires, I'll go for an invasive investigation also. When I go through the options here, you will notice that barium contrast may not be able to exactly pick up a mucosal disease. I would like real-time evidence of villus atrophy, and that would be determined with a small intestinal mucosal biopsy, because ultimately, if I can demonstrate villus atrophy, if I can pick up some problem with the lymphatic channels, if I can pick up bacteria like Trophorma vipulae, I would be spot on in my diagnosis. The answer to this question is option number C. Somebody mentioned Delta also. Breath hydrogen test, maine bataya tha yaar, that is a screening test for carbohydrate malabsorption. No need to delete, etc. I mean, it's okay. Even if you say it, doesn't matter. Nobody is pointing fingers at you. It's okay to be wrong, but then you have to realize that, okay, I went wrong, right? Screening test for carb metabolism is breath hydrogen test. So, jaise hum breath urea test karte hain H. pylori ke liye, breath carb is something that you do for breath hydrogen test is what you do for carb malabsorption per se. Answer is C. Good job, guys. Answer is a straightforward one. Let's move to the 20th one. D-xylose test, you very well know, xylose is a pentose sugar. And D-xylose is a test that is always done for evaluation of mucosal disease. So when I say that D-xylose test is normal, it means that the mucosal disease of the patient has been ruled out. I repeat the fact once again, normally the sugars that we consume are hexose sugars. Here we are giving a pentose sugar to the patient, and even if that is not getting absorbed, that means there is some problem in the patient with respect to the mucosa. But if it is getting, if the absorption is normal, that means there is no mucosal disease. Mucosal disease is ruled out. And normal Schilling's test, so when I say normal Schilling's test also, that means the fact that there is no problem with the terminal ileum of the patient, it's perfectly fine. It also means that the intrinsic factor of the patient is normal, the pancreatic enzymes are also normal. So you have to evaluate this question in the right sense, that what is really going on. Option number A cannot be the answer, because in pancreatitis, pancreatic enzymes are important for absorption of vitamin B12. So therefore, in chronic pancreatitis, Schilling's test will always be abnormal. In bacterial overgrowth syndrome, Schilling's test will again be abnormal because ileum is damaged, B12 will be lesser. In celiac disease, that means problem with, there will be abnormal D-xylose. For a couple of you who mentioned C as an answer, please remember the fact that celiac disease is a mucosal disease. There is a villus atrophy, so sugar will not get absorbed. If sugar will not get absorbed, neither hexose sugar, neither pentose sugar will get absorbed. So that is why it will be abnormal D-xylose test. But in the MCQ, I was mentioning both the tests are normal. If both the tests are normal, the diagnosis will be for which a biopsy has to be done, intestinal lymphangiectasia. And what this disease basically means, lymphangiectasia, is that there is abnormal lymphatic vessels. Because you very well know, fat is absorbed via the small gut. It is transported as chyle into the thoracic duct. Now, in lymphangiectasia, there is abnormal, I would say, lymphatic channels, as a result of which mostly these patients would be having steatorrhea. They will mainly be having problems with fat absorption because the lymphatic channels are not developed properly. The answer to this question is Delta. I repeat once again, because intestinal lymphangiectasia is not a disease of the mucosa. It's not a problem with respect to absorption of carbohydrates. In intestinal lymphangiectasia, the problem is not in the absorption of carbs. The problem is in with respect to fat is getting absorbed, but it cannot be channelized forward. So it's a conduction issue in a sense that the absorption is occurring, but aage nahi ja sakta because the channels, the lymphatic channels, are not formed properly. I hope, guys, you got this spot on. The point is, in intestinal lymphangiectasia, the problem is not per se that the mucosa is having a villus atrophy. The sugar is getting absorbed, but it's the carb, it's the fat component which is gonna be, you know, gonna be affected. And if the fat component is, I mean, it does a sartoria manifestation in the patient. So when you read this combination wala table na, that D-xylose Schilling test wala, so do read that table which is given in the GI section for malabsorption. So Sushant, you can go through malabsorption syndrome na. So usme jo last wala entry usme mentioned. Sushant, मुझे NB का member बनने की जरूरत नहीं है, वैसे ही इतनी सारी googly डालते हैं. आप देख लो जो recent papers होते हैं, सारे paper में ऐसा ही होता है. हर बार paper के बाद में बहुत distress होता है सबको. Answer to this question is delta. Just go through the. इतना दिमाग नहीं लगता exam में. हाँ, नहीं लगता. True, I agree to the fact. But simple वाले हो तो सही करने हैं ना. फिर भी यार 50-60% तो लाना ही है medicine. Okay. मोस्ट कॉमन एक्स्ट्रा इंटेस्टल मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ इन्फ्लेमेटरी बबल डिजीज. तो यहां पर तो हाँ, इफ ओनली इंट्रेंसिक फैक्टर के एडिशन से फिर शिलिंग टेस्ट नॉर्मल हो जाएगा ना. बट वेयर यू पुट अप दैट क्वेरी, यू एड इंट्रेंसिक फैक्टर, द B12 एब्जॉर्प्शन शिलिंग टेस्ट विल बिकम नॉर्मल. सो इफ यू रीड एमसीक्यू ऑफ द प्रीवियस ईयर्स, पेशेंट हैड एबनॉर्मल शिलिंग टेस्ट, इट बिकेम नॉर्मल विद इंट्रेंसिक फैक्टर एडिशन, देन इट्स गोना बी आई मीन ऑटोइम्यून गैस्ट्राइटिस. 21 says commonest extra-intestinal manifestation of inflammatory bowel disease. So these patients would be having problems with their joints. It would be rheumatological manifestations which are commonest seen. And when it comes to rheumatological manifestations, can you just quickly comment on which yeah, dermatological mein kya hota hai? Pyoderma gangrenosum hota hai. So is it the number one? No, it's the joint issues which are common, man. Pyoderma gangrenosum is a dermatological manifestation. Then we get erythema nodosum. Those manifestations are given unfairly. Sabse pehle to joint issues likhe hote hai na. The correct answer for 21 is Bombay. It's gonna be rheumatological manifestations. Can you comment on which joint is involved, guys? Yes, waiting for you guys to comment on which joint is involved in inflammatory bowel disease. Remember, HLA B27 positivity bhi ho sakti na IBD ke patient mein. Can I have the answer, please? If I say HLA B27 positivity can be present, then guys, exactly, it is sacroiliitis. It is sacroiliitis that can be present. So most patients with inflammatory bowel disease, when they come to you, they're not gonna talk about blood in the stool and weight loss and tiredness and anemia and swelling in the body, but they will also talk about pain in the joints, and that's mainly gonna be the low backache. It's the sacroiliitis issues that could be present in the patient. And I mean, you would have read HLA B27 positivity can be present even in patients of inflammatory bowel disease. Iske alawa, apart from this, these patients can also be having migratory polyarthritis. And where do you else read migratory polyarthritis? That is gonna be rheumatic fever. Jo bachcho mein milta na, arthritis jumping from one large joint to another with rheumatic fever. The same kind of profile can be present in these patients as well. In fact, lots of MCQs that come nowadays on inflammatory bowel disease topic, instead of asking you IBD, they ask you extra-intestinal manifestations first. So you go through the list per se, and it would be the rheumatological manifestations which are present initially. Yes, Dr. Bhavya, it's AS, ankylosing spondylitis like presentation, not exactly AS. Okay, good job for 21. We sorted. We move to 22. Which of the following is a feature of ulcerative colitis? Most patients would be having fresh blood in the stool. No, doc, it's not a DIP involvement. Yes, yes, guys, this is a spotter. In any chap with ulcerative colitis, there would be rectum involvement, no? So the number one involvement that you would be coming exactly is proctitis. It is a straightforward one. So see, there are some easy ones also. You can't blame me for saying that all are difficult ones. Somebody mentioned fistula formation. Doctor, that is a presentation of Crohn's disease. No? In Crohn's, you mainly have perianal fistulas. Crohn's, you have a cobblestone mucosa as well. Fever can be present in both of them, but obviously fever also and perianal abscess is present in Crohn's. So I mean, fever will be also more common in Crohn's disease per se. The most common part of the gut involved in ulcerative colitis rectum, that's why proctitis, so bloody diarrhea would be present. 22 was a sitter. Coming to 23, he says, which investigation is not required in the diagnosis of HLHS cardia? Second question on HLHS cardia for you guys. So the first one you messed up. Second one, I give you another opportunity, redemption time. Let us see how you fare in the redemption time. In any patient of HLHS cardia, you will anyway be doing a manometry that will tell you that there is non-peristaltic activity. In fact, I mean, normally with peristalsis, the pressure will vary. But in the lower part of the esophagus, there is non-peristaltic activity and the tone of the sphincter is increased. So two things contributing to dysphagia. I mean, the sphincter is tightly closed and there's a non-peristaltic activity. Barium swallow will reveal that classical picture. The bird big one, then would be antineuronal antibodies, because this condition can also be a paraneoplastic manifestation with lung cancer. Patients of lung cancer can be having anti-HU antibodies. Those anti-HU antibodies are the ones which will damage the Myentric plexus, that was Auerbach plexus, and that causes HLHS cardia. The answer to this question will be delta enterocolysis. Enterocolysis basically means small bubble studies. And obviously HLHS cardia is a disease of the esophagus. So, I mean, we are not going to evaluate the small bubble of the patient. Yes. Answer to 23 is delta. So, another one, right, that you have got in your kitty. Yeah, anti-nuclear, I mean, if it is associated with the autoimmune panel, Bhavya Raj, that autoimmune panel has anti-nuclear antibody and others. So if it is associated with any connective tissue disorder, HLHS, then we can pick it up. Okay. Anomic aphasia. I'll just explain what I mean by the word anomic aphasia. Like if I show you this cell phone, then you can say it is a cell phone. I'm not asking you the brand per se, but if I say ki ye kya hai, then you can tell me, you know, that this is a cell phone. But in anomic aphasia, when you show an object to a person, like if this is a remote control, right, of an air conditioner, or if this is going to be a cell phone, if I show these common items to the patient, he will not be able to name that. He knows at the back of the mind that this is a cell phone, this is a remote control, right? But he will not be able to speak it out properly because his brain is confused. So the meaning of the word anomic aphasia is difficulty in naming an object. It is not that the Broca's area is not working. I would say Broca's area smashed, because if Broca's area is totally gone, then obviously person cannot speak. If a person is having damage to Wernicke's area, he cannot understand what you are saying, receptive dysphagia. Here, he can both maybe name an object, but it might take a while, or he might be able to name it incorrectly. The point is, anomic aphasia is a feature that is always going to be associated with, yes guys, waiting for answers from you. Okay, let's start with A, middle cerebral territory stroke. So MC territory is going to be supplying both the Broca's area as well as the Wernicke's area. I mean, the blood supply of the Broca's area is superior division of MC. Blood supply of Wernicke's area is inferior. I've drawn a diagram like this. I've said this is left middle cerebral artery. The superior division will be supplying the Wernicke's area and the inferior division will be supplying the Wernicke's area. And if there's going to be a thrombus here, if there's going to be clot here, then this clot will cut off both the blood supply to Broca's and Wernicke's area. And therefore, neither the person will be able to understand what you are saying, and neither will be able to speak. So MC territory stroke mein toh global aphasia hota hai. In MC territory stroke, if I say inferior division is gone, Wernicke's area is gone, understanding will be a problem, receptive. If superior division is gone, Broca's area is gone, toh bol nahi payega. That is expressive dysphagia. But if the main supply is gone, then both systems are shut down. Neither he can understand, neither he can speak. That is what you call as global aphasia. ग्लोबल एफेजिया में तो वो कुछ बोल ही नहीं सकता ना यार, उसको तो समझ में भी नहीं आएगा. यहाँ पे उसको समझ में आ रहा है, इज अंडरस्टैंडिंग इट इज अ सेल फोन, बात करते हैं. हो सकता है कि ही माइट पुट इट टू हिज ईयर एंड से दिस इज फॉर टॉकिंग. I said, what is this? Right? I gave it to the patient. I said, what is this? He's trying to put it to the ear and he's trying to tell me that this is used for, you know, talking on the phone, talking with somebody, but he's not able to name something as simple as, and I'm not talking about some illiterate villager from rural India who's never seen a cell phone in his life. He has a latest generation of cell phone available with him, but he's not able to say the words. That means the brain is confused with a metabolic encephalopathy. The correct answer for 24 is Bombay guys, hepatic encephalopathy. When it comes to frontal lobe injury, frontal lobe injury mein to patient does not want to speak at all. Usko bolte abulia. Abulia aur aphasia a ki baat nahi hoti hai. Abulia ka matlab hota hai. Meaning of the word abulia is lack of desire to speak. A person with frontal lobe damage, he might be a chatterbox. Like he might be talking in front of his son saying, when doctor will come, I will tell him this complaint, right? He will make a list of 10 complaints in front of his son. Let the doctor come. I'll tell constipation bhi hai, ye bhi hai, ye bhi hai. He's telling lot of problems. But when the doctor is in front, he is not saying anything because of lack of desire to speak. Or when you say, okay, talk to me, he might give you a choicest cuss word. Gali de rahe ho. Patient is using abusive words with you. So in abulia, it is not that he is not able to speak. He does not want to speak. He might deliberately use cuss words with you also. In Parkinsonism, you will notice that person will speak very slowly. It will be very difficult for you to understand what the patient is saying. You will have to bring your ears close to the face of the patient. Ki, sir, Baba ji, kya bol rahe ho? So when you bring your ears close to the face of the patient, because the voice pitch is reduced, that is hypomimia or bradyphrenia. People with Parkinsonism, wo bahut halke bolte hai. Matlab agar main is time pe bahut whispering shuru kar du, to aap logo ko samajh nahi aayega na ki main kya bol raha hu. So hypomimia, bradyphrenia are features that you see with Parkinsonism, where mainly the person will speak very, very slowly. The point is, whenever you are going to be having anomic aphasia, it's always going to be metabolic encephalopathy. The correct answer to question number 24 is Bombay. The points which are to be remembered for this particular case is, in hepatic enceph, doctor, ammonia intoxication, no? So the neurons are not going to be able to fire properly. So he knows it's a cell phone. His facial expression is telling you it's a cell phone. I mean, he's like, what the hell? Is this a question? I mean, are you asking me what is this? I know what is this. That's the kind of facial expression that the patient would be having before you. I mean, he is behaving as if you are a silly person. You are asking me, ye kya hai? But you say, sir, tell me the name. He's looking confused because his brain is not able to select the words. So in hepatic encephalopathy, uremic encephalopathy, and you would have seen it in your ICU patients also who are having delirium, that they become very slow in responding. Answer to question number 24 is Bombay. Guys, get these facts right. I mean, I expected you to be able to pick it up, and do pick up this words, global aphasia, that's MCA territory stroke. Expressive dysphasia, that is Wernicke's area damage. If it is going to be Broca's area damage, if it is Wernicke's, it is receptive, and if it is Broca's, it is expressive dysphasia. Doc, it's not a specific area, it's the coordination between the areas, Rishi, which is affected. The neurons are not able to coordinate with each other because you have lot of stimuli, right? I'm writing, I am speaking, I'm doing hand actions. Combination of this are being registered by your brain, and that is when you type in your mobile and you ask me a query. So all that multiple input needs coordination. I mean, for you to put up a query in the chat box, you need to be looking at my screen, looking at my facial expression, looking at the words that I'm writing, and then you're able to integrate that. That integration is the one which is hampered in patients of metabolic encephalopathy, like hepatic enceph or uremic enceph in your hospitals. And that's why the person will not be able to respond to a simple query of something as common as a cell phone. I mean, I gave an example cell phone because, I mean, that's something that's so common. Answer to 24 is Bombay. We move to the next one. He says, you are the intern on duty and you are asked to evaluate a case of increased anion gap in an ABG report. All of the following are the causes, except, okay. So for 25, okay, Anupam gave a delayed answer, but good job. Let's move to 25. For anion gap, you see normal anion gap values you are anyway aware of. And whenever you calculate the anion gap, do not take into consideration the values of potassium. Word of caution here for everybody, do not put values of potassium, they will be given in the question. Though in some physiology books and in some physiology notes, they incorporate the potassium values, but actually potassium is not to be included. And then you have increase in NAND gap, and then you have a normal in NAND gap, and the mnemonic for increase in NAND gap is cult. You need to deploy cult. Cult would be ketoacidosis, uremia, lactic acidosis, and then toxins. Let's evaluate it. Ketoacidosis is on. Acute tubular necrosis would contribute to development of uremia. After all, I mean, when the kidneys would fail, this could be contrast nephropathy. This could be multiple myeloma causing acute tubular necrosis. The bottom line is uremia will contribute to increase in NAND gap. Then I said toxins. T would stand for toxins, and the toxin which is incorporated here is ethylene glycol. So the correct answer for this would be option number delta. That would be renal tubular acidosis. In fact, that's the crux that I want you to remember. The mnemonic for normal NAND gap is Dr. Fuse. Now I know the fact that you guys are aware of this, but still just be patient with me for next 30 seconds so that I can just squeeze in this information. In diarrhea, there is equal loss of positive and negative charges. Sodium is a positive charge, bicarbonate is a negative charge. If both are lost equal, if both negative charges are lost equal, NAND gap will remain normal. In renal tubular acidosis, again equal charges are lost, positive and negative. F would stand for fistula. So the body secretions would be losing positive and negative in equal amount. Go by mathematics, man. Positive charge becomes lesser, negative also becomes lesser. Both become lesser by equal amount. So mathematical value will remain same. And use would be for uretrosigmoidostomy. Just do yourself a favor. On a piece of paper, if you were not able to crack this, I'm really glad, but if you were not able to crack this, just stick it on a piece of paper and put it somewhere, cult versus Dr. Fuse. And though I've given you the mathematical version for this also, but then cult versus Fuse will sort out the issues of normal NAND gap versus increase in NAND gap, and they love to ask about it. Okay. mud piles will become a little longer, doctor, and would not help you in ensuring a good strike rate. So I know the fact that a lot of people use that mud piles which is available on the internet, but I thought of shorter versions which help you crack questions in a shorter time frame with a higher strike rate. I could have used mud piles also, but then that mud pile mnemonic is something which is available easily on the internet. Not that I'm discrediting the person who created that mud piles thing. It's a very good mnemonic, but usually does not work in that time constraint period. So it has to be shorter and precise. Anybody who has done a bit of reading with my notes, if you can just comment on this decreased NAND gap. I have told you normal and increased. Can you tell me any condition where you have read about decrease NAND gap? Yes, guys. Quickly, guys. NAND gap is going to be reduced in which condition? Okay, the hint is you get an M spike in this condition. Can I have the answer? Fastest finger first. With an NG tube, no doc, if you put an NG tube, it will only cause metabolic alkalosis, no? So you would be having normal NAND gap most of the time. Sodium and chloride both would be lesser in equal amounts. Bicarbonate would be higher, in fact. Yes, plasma cell dyscharia, decrease in NAND gap would be seen in patients of multiple myeloma. And also in patients of nephrotic syndrome. This was a difficult one. So if you are not going to remember conditions of decrease in NAND gap, I'm perfectly okay with it. But yep, the normal one and the increased one are something that I definitely want you to remember. Okay, so we are sorted with this one. Good, very good, very good. Ashok came up with the answer, Prakhar, everybody, very good. Fine, we move to 26 for today. Easier one, falsely elevated hemoglobin would be seen in. So with these questions, I hope now nobody is complaining. nobody is not complaining regarding that, whether I should be an examiner or not, because you're getting them right. So that's mean, because easier ones, you are anyway gonna score in the exam, right? No, Bhavya, the body has a tendency to lose positive and negative charges in equal amounts. So hyponatremia, you would not be having a decrease in NAND gap. Okay, falsely elevated hemoglobin would be encountered in patients of very standard scenario. You see, in chronic renal failure, erythropoietin will be lesser. Erythropoietin is required for synthesis of hemoglobin, so hemoglobin will be low. And in the last two conditions, it is hemoglobinuria. So because there is lysis of RBCs, so again, hemoglobin will be lesser. The answer by exclusion will obviously be burns, because in burns you get a hemoconcentration, and the moment I say hemoconcentration, you pick up the word relative polycythemia is a feature that you see here. Answer for this is Bombay. Okay, moving to the next one for today. Okay, 27th. It says, which of the following is not a test for malabsorption syndrome? D-xylose is anyway used. Fecal fat estimation is used. Quickly, guys, I want quicker answers for these ones so that we can move forwards. As I told you, breath hydrogen test is done for carb malabsorption. But you read about urine amino aciduria most of the time with the... the answer to this question is clear. That is delta, urine amino aciduria. Please do comment upon disease where you have read about urine amino aciduria. Yes, we usually read it with damage to the proximal converted tubule. We read about urine amino aciduria in patients of Fanconi syndrome. We read it with renal tubular acidosis type 2 and even with inborn errors of metabolism. The ones that you read in pathology, you know, like cystinosis. So there might be excessive loss of amino acids in the urine of the patient as well. Cystinuria, low A, yep, lots of diseases that come up, like inborn errors of metabolism. Answer to 27 is delta. Coming to question number 28. Flapping tremor is seen in all the following conditions except you read about fine tremors and then you read about flapping tremors. For flapping tremors, you would be dorsiflexing the hand of the patient, and this is very common with metabolic encephalopathies, and that would my word of metabolic encephalopathy should make it easier for you. Yes, in patients of type 2 respiratory failure, there will be carbon dioxide narcosis, and this is an example of metabolic encephalopathy. So therefore you would definitely be having is a flapping tremor present. Anxiety neurosis will be having mainly sympathomimetic stimulation. So this is bound to produce fine tremors and looks like the answer to the question. Let's read about hepatic encephalopathy, grade 3, CKD grade 5. I mean, those terms have only been put only for the heck of it. Otherwise, you can very well understand that option number C and D are talking about hepatic encephalopathy and uremic encephalopathy. The correct answer for question number 28 is Bombay. The bottom line is option number A, C and D are all examples of metabolic encephalopathy. Yep. Answer is Bombay for 28. Hepatic encephalopathy may be wahi hoga na yaar. There would be excess of ammonia. The ammonia will irritate the neurons. So you might be getting is flapping tremor present again. You read about wing beating tremor. That is Wilson disease. When you read the word wing beating tremor, that's for Wilson. But flapping tremors are with metabolic encephalopathy. A fine tremor, doctor, would be between the fingers, no? I mean, fine tremors would be like if I'm very nervous in an exam, or let me say if I'm going for a viva, if I go back to my third year in MAMC, and when I used to have that pharmacology class, there was a professor who used to use choicest words. He's retired now, but then if we used to get questions wrong about all that vasomotor reversal or Dale, we used to get abuses. So the first time I walked into, you know, his viva, it started abusing me. I really felt bad. And I started sweating in my palms and I started having shaking of my fingers. So that would be, fine tremors. Though traditionally, I would say fine tremors as a term is mainly used for excessive sympathomimetic stimulation, and it can be seen even in patients of anxiety neurosis. So, and flapping would be the whole hand having these kind of manifestations. And what I'll do, you know, in 4.0 will be that I'll put on some videos of these kind of manifestations in the actual video itself, so that you guys don't have to fumble for differentiating between fine tremor versus flapping tremor, where the whole hand would be having a movement versus that of the fingers. Answer for 28 is Bombay. We doctors all have PTSD, you know. I mean, medical college vivas are always post-traumatic stress disorder, contribute to PTSD subsequently. Okay, fine. Not that all examiners are like that. It's only some who would be, you know, causing that. Most of them are friendly, I would say. It's just that some people take it personally. That's when problems would occur. Okay, fine. Coming to 29, enough of chit chat. Red rice water stool will be seen in which of the following conditions? So we're obviously looking for cholera, which is not there. And that means if cholera is not there, we're looking for pancreatic cholera, that is a VIPoma. And VIPoma will make the diagnosis of this patient as option number Bombay. Pretty standard. I mean, you always read about vasoactive intestinal tumors or vasoactive intestinal polypeptide producing tumor, which can contribute to secretory diarrhea in a patient. The alternative name for this would also be Werner-Morrison syndrome. Okay, so we move on to question number 30th for today. Answer is Bombay. Carcinoid, yep, can again contribute to secretory diarrhea. 30th says which of the following is not a feature of Zollinger-Ellison syndrome? You see, in Zollinger-Ellison, there is excess of acid, and that acid damages the mucosa of the duodenum. So, in Zollinger-Ellison, you not only get secretory diarrhea, but you also get osmotic diarrhea. I wanna clarify this here once again. Guys, my point is, if you're gonna be having more acid, that acid will damage the wall of the duodenum. Because after all, you see, in the duodenum, you have those crypts of Leber Cohen and your Brenner's glands, but they will be overwhelmed. I mean, there's so much of acid being produced that ultimately everything in the defense mechanism would be overwhelmed. So there's mucosal damage, and that means that sugar will not be absorbed. So you get an osmotic diarrhea component. Gastrin per se itself can contribute to secretory diarrhea, but acid will cause damage to mucosa and cause osmotic diarrhea. So that's why in Zollinger-Ellison, the diarrhea of the patient can be, a combination of osmotic and secretory diarrhea. But primarily because there definitely can be a secretory diarrhea component present, so option A makes sense. Because diarrhea non-responsive to fasting basically means that we are talking about secretory diarrhea. So don't be under the impression that Zollinger-Ellison has a pure secretory, it's a combination. Patient will obviously be having epigastric pain because these patients would be having ulcers in usually even in the second part of the duodenum. I mean, you not only might be having a giant duodenal ulcer in the first part of the duodenum, these chaps could be having even ulcer in the second part of the duodenum. So epigastric pain will definitely be present. Secretin study is the best way for diagnosis. So your answer is C, and you picked up beautifully here. Cameron ulcer is the one that we commonly see with hiatus hernia, and we don't read that with literature. Zollinger-Ellison. Answer to question number 30 is option number C. Good pickup by almost everybody. Okay. Coming to question number 31, let's sort this out. An elderly patient with uncontrolled diabetes has gone out. In the group, somebody mentioned someone special. I'll definitely answer you, sir. Just give me some time. Once we're done with this, I'll answer to this query of yours. Okay, Dr. Lucifer, I'll try to do that. It's already present in the app, no? That reading Harrison thing, no? There's a video by the name of 5 Hacks to Crack NEET PG, and it's not only for NEET PG, it's for all exams. I mentioned topics and I mentioned attitude about what you should be doing. So I would request you to just go through that video, and that would give you sufficient insights into, the query that you've read. I mean, you first time you read Harrison, it obviously contributes to a lot of sleepiness, but things can be improved. Okay, let's move it on. You have an elderly patient with uncontrolled diabetes, and this person has he ate Chinese noodles, and then he's having vomiting episodes, and he started feeling very weak, and he's not able to walk. He's not able to talk also. I mean, weakness is so bad after vomiting that he is not able to, even talk also. And you've admitted the person, and his ABG is showing 7.5, which is elevated. PCO2, which is on the higher side of normal, and bicarbonate is also elevated. So the patient is suffering from metabolic alkalosis. So for those of you who have assumed that the answer is Bombay, answer is not Bombay. Please read the question very carefully. You give insulin drip for diabetic ketoacidosis. You gave insulin drip for management of ketoacidosis. I repeat the fact, you give it for acidosis. आपने क्वेश्चन पढ़ा ही नहीं, आपने एबीजी का रिपोर्ट देखा ही नहीं पेशेंट को। ऐसे नहीं होता सर। इंसुलिन ड्रिप इज गिवन फॉर मैनेजमेंट ऑफ डायबिटिक कीटोएसिडोसिस बिकॉज इट ट्रीट्स द कीटोन प्रोडक्शन। व्हाई आर कीटोन्स बीइंग प्रोड्यूस्ड? डेफिशिएंसी ऑफ इंसुलिन। सो यू गिव इंसुलिन ड्रिप फॉर कीटोएसिडोसिस। अवर पेशेंट इज नॉट हैविंग कीटोएसिडोसिस, ही इज हैविंग मेटाबॉलिक एल्कलोसिस। फॉर मेटाबॉलिक एल्कलोसिस व्हाट डू यू गिव? यू गिव नॉर्मल सलाइन। दिस इज नॉट अ केस ऑफ डायबिटिक कीटोएसिडोसिस सर। नॉट एवरी एमसीक्यू डायबिटीज विल एंड अप विद डायबिटिक कीटोएसिडोसिस। अ लॉट ऑफ यू हैव पिक्ड इट अप ब्यूटीफुली, अ लॉट ऑफ यू यू नो casually read it. I mean, that's why the problem would have occurred. And C says give antiemetics and send home on ORS therapy. Then guys, I mean, a guy with metabolic alkalosis with this kind of a report, I will not be comfortable sending him home. Unless and until I'm short of hospital beds. No? Unless and until I am short of beds, unless and until I am like, you know, having a COVID-like situation where I don't want to admit a non-COVID patient to the hospital and say, ghar le jao. I mean, it does not make sense to, you know, just send the patient back home. And giving oxygen 6 liters per minute, I mean, there is no demonstration of any hypoxia in the patient. There is no demonstration of any respiratory distress in the patient. I mean, I agree he's feeling weak, but that weakness will come after vomiting, no? I mean, if somebody will puke 2-3 times, you know, put it on yourself, you eat food and suddenly you start puking due to food poisoning, obviously you will feel weak, right? That's electrolyte imbalances that would come due to aldosterone aspect. The correct answer for this question is alpha. The point to be understood is that in any patient who's having, I mean, the question begins with diabetes, don't assume it is metabolic acidosis. In any patient who's diabetic, if he's gonna be having metabolic alkalosis, which is a possibility due to vomiting, then it is to be, I mean, corrected on a war footing in a sense that the patient needs to be admitted. Okay, good job, Dr. Aishwarya, Dr. Aksha, Dr. Malay, good job. Let's move to the next one. This one says, in a patient who's having acute renal failure, which of the following manifestations would be seen? So the basic function of the kidney is excretion of potassium as well as hydrogen. And every time the kidney will fail, neither potassium and neither, I would say, hydrogen would be excreted. I would like you to... I would like you to comment in the chat box quickly, guys. It's a long session, guys. You can watch it later also. If you want to leave, it's okay. I said in acute kidney injury, the bottom line is the patient would be having inability to excrete potassium as well as hydrogen. So if you are not able to kick out potassium and you're not able to kick out hydrogen, it will contribute to hyperkalemic acidosis in the patient. The answer to this question is option number C. And what they simply did in the exam was they modulated this by asking you for hypokalemic acidosis also. That would obviously be diarrhea. Standard one-liner statements, hyperkalemic acidosis and hypokalemic acidosis. The answers are here before you. And for hypokalemic alkalosis, it's usually going to be congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Any condition in which aldosterone is more. Option number B would come in. So whether he wants to put in endocrine conditions like Kahn syndrome, or he wants to put up ascites in a patient, he wants to put up congestive heart failure. Obviously, I'm talking about chronic congestive heart failure. Because if it's acute congestive heart failure, it will contribute to renal failure and a metabolic acidosis. In DKA, doctor, we give normal saline to correct the dehydration, Dr. Krishna put up. In all patients with diabetic ketoacidosis, you send in a potassium sample right at the starting of the treatment and start the patient. First thing to be done is give a bolus of insulin, bolus shot. That is at 0.1 units per kilogram of body weight. Then you give IV fluids to the patient to correct the dehydration component, because after all patients with DKA are having excessive amount of osmotic diuresis, and that causes obviously electrolyte imbalance. And then you start the patient on insulin drip as well, which can be given via infusion pump. So I repeat again, in any patient with DKA on admission, you would give a bolus shot of insulin, but don't give the entire insulin right away. Because blood sugar might be 250-300, you give all the insulin together, it's going to contribute to hypoglycemia. I want an insulin drip to gradually go into the body, because I want to shut down ketone production. In DKA, my objective is not to control the blood sugar. In DKA, it's not the sugar that's the troublemaker, it is the ketones that are the troublemaker. I want to shut down the factory of ketones. And why are ketones produced deficiency of insulin? So you're doing a hormone replacement. So give a bolus of insulin, give normal saline to the patient, and give a insulin drip. Okay, answer to question number 32 is Calcutta. We are done with 32. Given alternative scenarios, we move to 33. You have a patient admitted of CKD stage 4 and insulin is excreted via the kidney. Now, because insulin is excreted by the kidney itself, if you will continue with the same dose of insulin, then it will cause hypoglycemia. I think I made the answer very obvious here. It's a pharma slash medicine based scenario. What are you going to do for this particular patient? You need to adjust the dose of insulin, and what will be the adjustment that would be done in this case? You will be, yes, guys, can I have the answer, please? I repeat the fact once again. In case you missed it out, my statement is insulin is excreted via the kidney. So if I'm going to continue with the same dose of insulin in a chap who's having renal failure, insulin will not be metabolized. If insulin is not metabolized, it will cause hypoglycemia. Now he will start having sympathomimetic stimulation manifestations. So what am I supposed to do for this chap? I am supposed to change the dose of insulin. To kya karoge, sir? Will you like to raise the dose of insulin or decrease? You will decrease the dose of insulin in all patients with chronic kidney disease. You only give 80% of the total calculated dose. I repeat the fact once again. Why are you giving only 80% of the calculated dose? Is because of the fact that if you give the normal dosage, it will not be excreted, and therefore it will contribute to hypoglycemia in the patient. So dose adjustment is required. Answer to 33 is Bombay. I got a D as an answer input as well. We first give oral hypoglycemic drugs. If they're not working, we usually add insulin to the patient. In any CKD patient with diabetes mellitus, because most patients are having diabetic nephropathy, you very well know the leading cause of CKD in India is diabetic nephropathy. Occurred, you on a regular basis need to calculate their GFR. If you notice the fact that the GFR of the patient is significantly reduced, I mean, in this chap, the GFR will be, I mean, substantially reduced, something in the range of about 15, less than 30, no, 15 to 29 ml per minute. I mean, that's pretty dire straits, because this chap is very soon gonna be having you to decide that should he be undergoing a dialysis or should he be going in for a transplantation. So considering that fact that, you know, he would require a dose adjustment, you will have to manage the patient accordingly. Okay. I hope, Rahul, it's fine now. It's working fine on my end. Okay, I'll wait for a while. Should get settled by itself. I don't need to do anything or do much. Intermittent connectivity. Chalo. Fine. Javed, ek thumbs up de dena so that I know everything is working fine and we can move on to the next one. Okay, Om, thanks. Yes, guys. I hope the network is fine now. Okay, I had two queries on the dosage of insulin. Doc, I can you can send me these queries on my email, marvamedicine@gmail. I'll be able to talk about insulin dosage adjustment. I mean, for which varieties of insulin on one-to-one basis, because that would be out of the domain. I have to cover 71 here, as I promised to these guys. Doc, in patients who are having CKD, you see, once the insulin level, we're talking about regular insulin here, the one that we are using, or in case we are even using short-acting insulin, even that would be requiring a dose adjustment. I might have missed one query that went up, so please mail me that. Okay. Okay, coming to question number 34, it's on the screen now. He says, which of the following is not seen in alcoholic patients? You would usually see that alcoholics would be having, I mean, I would say distrust of their partner. So morbid jealousy is on. You read about a mnemonic by the name of GOA, Global Confusion Ophthalmoplegia, and then you also get about ataxia as a manifestation. So ophthalmoplegia is what is being talked about in this case. That would be sixth nerve palsy. Why I'm saying GOA mnemonic is, I hope everybody remembers, in alcoholics, if they stop drinking alcohol, if they continue drinking alcohol, they can be having is a development of thiamine deficiency, and that will cause Wernicke's encephalopathy. And then you would also be having manifestations of damage to the cerebellum, Bergmann gliosis. Okay, that's the answer that I'm getting. No, guys, it's Bergmann gliosis is rather a manifestation that you see with the patients who are having long-term alcohol intake. It is cerebellar damage that would be seen. The correct answer for this question is delta, perseveration. The person will get stuck at one point. Perseveration is what you usually get classically with patients, pediatric age group, you get it in autism. ऑटिज्म वाला जो बच्चा होता है ना, वो एक ही एक्टिविटी को बार बार करेगा. लाइक ही वुड बी वेयरिंग द सेम ड्रेस एवरी डे, और ही विल रिक्वायर वन पर्टिकुलर टॉय एवरी सिंगल डे. आई मीन इफ यू डोंट गिव दैट टॉय टू दैट चाइल्ड, ही विल जस्ट बिहेव, ही विल जस्ट कीप ऑन सल्किंग, और ही कीप ऑन हाउलिंग, एंड विल बी डिफिकल्ट टू मैनेज. सो दे गेट स्टक. आई मीन द मदर विल से दीज वर्ड्स, द डॉक्टर, माई चाइल्ड हैज दिस पर्टिकुलर फिक्सेशन फॉर अ पीस ऑफ क्लॉथ. इट कुड बी लाइक अ स्मॉल ब्लैंकेट, इट कुड बी अ पर्टिकुलर टॉय, इट कुड बी स्टफ्ड टॉय. आई मीन वो जब तक वो नहीं है, तो वो बच्चा मतलब वो और कोई एक्टिविटी कर नहीं सकता. एंड यू विल सी चिल्ड्रन विद ऑटिज्म, दे कीप ऑन प्लेइंग द सेम गेम अगेन एंड अगेन एंड अगेन एंड अगेन. आई मीन यू दे विल कीप ऑन रीअरेंजिंग थिंग्स. सो आई मीन आई एम नॉट टॉकिंग अबाउट ओसीडी गाइस, आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट किड विद ऑटिज्म. सो परसिवरेशन मीन्स द पर्सन इज स्टक एट वन वन सिंगल थिंग. दैट्स वॉट यू यूजली गेट इन पीडियाट्रिक्स विद ऑटिज्म, एंड परसिवरेशन इज वॉट यू ऑल्सो रीड इन पेशेंट्स ऑफ शिजोफ्रेनिया. दो ऑब्वियसली इन शिजोफ्रेनिया वी हैव प्रॉपर डायग्नोस्टिक क्राइटेरिया, लॉट ऑफ अदर मैनिफेस्टेशन, बट one of them would be present. Dr. Malay had important aspect saying Devdas. Then I want to say that Devdas was not perseveration, it was basically, I would say, something lesser than morbid jealousy. I mean, he wanted her, you see, per se. So I would say that that aspect of Devdas is something that is not related to point number D. It is it's more related to, I would say, spectrum of option number A. Answer to question number 34 is delta. Answer is delta, guys. We move to the next question for today. Dr. Malay, you made an interesting observation, but I would say that that would more border on option number A. I mean, jilted lover, you would call it, or jilted love life is very common. Alcoholics never have stable relationships, as you know. Okay, moving to 35. This is a 26-year-old chap. He's having chemotherapy being received for Hodgkin's lymphoma, and he's having vomiting because chemotherapy induces vomiting. So he says, I mean, which part of the brain would be the one that would be involved in this case? Dr. Sharma, you said child is having tendency to wash hands again and again. Doc, first I would like you to talk to you can go to CD department, child development unit in MAMC. They have a beautiful child development unit, very very exceptionally good. Autism is what I would think first, but obviously other diagnostic. When we talk about the vomiting part, it would be area postrema that is involved. I mean, you very well know that vomiting is related, I mean the vomiting center per se is related to area postrema itself. 35 I think was a spotter, easy one to be picked up. Yes. Let's move to the next question for today. A 70-year-old woman, she's having progressive neurological disorder resulting in degeneration of the anterior horn cells through her spinal cord and in the brainstem as well. Now, anterior horn cells are obviously in the spinal cord, but he's basically talking about damage to the cells in the spinal cord. So the disease that we are thinking here, because anterior horn cells are getting involved. So anterior horn cells are usually involved in which diseases? One of them would be motor neuron disease. I mean, that's what is the likely diagnosis in this particular case, considering the geriatric age group? And then in pediatric age group, you also read about a disease called as SMA, spinomuscular atrophy. where anterior horn cells in the spinal cord can be involved. And amyotrophic lateral sclerosis is a variant of motor neuron disease. The first and the foremost differential of mine for this question is point number one that I've written, and the question says which is most likely to be a manifestation in this case. So the correct answer for this would be that the patient would be suffering from features of lower motor neuron lesion. I mean, since I said anterior horn cell, lower motor neuron lesion would contribute to fasciculations in the patient. Asterisks is what you see with the metabolic encephalopathy, like hepatic NSF or uremic NSF, so can be ruled out. Chorea as a manifestation is what you see with the damage to the cortical nucleus, so that's off the radar. And chorea is also seen, Sydenham's chorea or I would say Huntington's chorea, and both of them are not making or fitting the bill. And for people who are saying D, guys, gait apraxia is same as magnetic gait. And magnetic gait is a feature that is always seen with damage to the frontal lobe. I repeat the fact once again, gait apraxia and magnetic gait both mean the same. It's the anterior cerebral artery which is hampered in this case. The answer to this question would be option number C, fasciculations, primarily because lower motor neuron is the one that is affected. Okay, fine. I think everybody picked it up correctly. Answer to 36 is Calcutta. Moving to the next one. Atrial fibrillation leads to development of what kind of stroke? In atrial fibrillation, because the atria would be twitching, so there would be development of clots in the left atrial appendage, and these clots can then embolize into the systemic circulation, for which obviously problems would be occurring. Spinomuscular atrophy would be a pediatric presentation, no? So that would be, I mean, unlikely as a diagnosis in this particular case. Okay, yes guys, waiting for your comments here. In atrial fibrillation, the clots will go to the brain, so it will contribute to development of embolic stroke. And when I say embolic stroke, then obviously the answer will be A. That is what happens in 80% of the cases. And if you have mitral stenosis with the left atrial appendage clots, then you have to give warfarin to the patient. But whenever it is non-valvular atrial fibrillation, do remember the technical information I'm saying. I'm saying if a person is having atrial fibrillation and he is a known case of mitral stenosis, you very well know he will develop clots. So what drug would be given to prevent the development of clots? I mean, and prevent development of stroke? Answer is warfarin. But if it is non-valvular atrial fibrillation with left atrial appendage clots, then we will be using NOACs for the patient, novel oral anticoagulants. Both of these technical aspects are to be remembered by you. I repeat the fact once again. If you read the fact that a chap is having mitral stenosis, he is having atrial fibrillation, and he can develop stroke any day, I will give warfarin to the patient to prevent development of stroke. But if it is non-valvular atrial fibrillation, example of non-valvular atrial fibrillation can be like dilated cardiomyopathy, then I will be giving novel oral anticoagulants to the patient to prevent the development of stroke. And lacunostroke, somebody mentioned, so lacunostroke is seen with hypertension, it is seen with diabetes mellitus. See, even if clots are not documented by echo, that does not mean that the clots are not there or may not develop, because they might be too small to be picked up. When you do a transthoracic echocardiography, transthoracic echocardiography may not be able to pick up the clots in the left atrial appendage, so ideally you should be doing a transesophageal echo. Now imagine telling an Indian patient that I'm going to put a probe in your esophagus and do a transesophageal echo, he'll never agree to it. So we have to rely on transthoracic, and our hospitals mein to transthoracic bhi bahut bar nahi hota, emergency mein to nahi hota. So my point is, I'm not going to wait for somebody to, you know, get a echo done and then decide on anticoagulation if I have a chap who's documented atrial fibrillation, because it's a chronic presentation. In any chap with atrial fibrillation, if you are having TIA like event, don't wait for echo to show demonstration of a clot. In fact, in question wo janbujh ke likh sakta hai, echo of the patient is normal. Even if it is written na, echo is normal and clots nahi hai, that does not mean that abhi nahi hai na. Raat mein ban sakte hain, kal subah tak ban sakte hain. Clots can develop na. Thrombogenic state clot banne mein bahut zyada time to nahi lagta. So if E equals normal at the moment, there can be two possibilities. Either the clots are too small or the test you have done is not spot on. I mean, you've done a transthoracic echocardiography, or they can develop subsequently. So the point is, anticoagulation must be done to prevent the development of stroke in these patients. And what is the type of stroke present? It is ischemic stroke, which is the commonest variety. Lacunar stroke is common in small blood vessels. Lacunar stroke mein kya hota hai? It is I would say younger brother of atherosclerosis. देखो मैंने I did not write the word atherosclerosis. मैंने बोला जरूर, but what did I say? Lipohyalinosis. Of which blood vessels? The ultra small blood vessels. I'm not talking about ACA, MCA, PCA. I'm talking about lipohyalinosis of the perforator blood vessels, जो smaller branches of all the blood vessels that I mentioned. अगर उसमें disease present होता है, that we call it lipohyalinosis of perforators. You can consider this disease as younger brother of atherosclerosis of, let me say, abdominal aorta. I mean, if I say atherosclerosis of abdominal aorta, big lesion, no? If I say atherosclerosis of coronary artery, big lesion. Now reduce the size of blood vessels. Reduce the size of blood vessels. Think of ultra small blood vessels in the brain. Those are perforators that go deep down into the tissue of the brain. And if they are the ones which are affected by hypertension, diabetes, then we call it lacunar stroke. Answer to question number 37 is alpha, though I've given information with respect to other aspects also. And hemorrhagic stroke, you very well know, is very commonly seen with, apart from CNS injury, I mean, I'm talking about head injury. Most of the scenarios given to you in the exam can be with respect to hypertensive crisis, and that can contribute to hemorrhagic stroke in a patient. Let's move to the next one, 38. Which of the following is true about SIADH? Spot on answers expected in this case. In SIADH, there will be more water coming up in the body, right? And if there's more water in the body, then it will contribute to development of sodium being lesser. So SIADH has definitely a hyponatremia, but that hyponatremia is present in two of the options. So I'm still looking for answers here. Yes. In any patient of SIADH, do remember the fact that you would be having is a euvolemic hyponatremia. The correct answer for this is option number alpha, because even if the water in the body is more and sodium is lesser, it does not mean it is hypervolemic. Best example of hypervolemic hyponatremia would be congestive heart failure and for ascites, and in fact, acute kidney injury first. Congestive heart failure, acute kidney injury, they are scenarios where you would be having a hypervolemic hyponatremia. But SIADH is example of euvolemic hyponatremia. I mean, more water in the body does not mean that it is hypervolemic. It means it is euvolemic. For hypervolemic, both things should be elevated. Total body water should also be more, and salt in the body should also be more. Now you can see that I put two arrows for total body water and one arrow for salt to say that why is there a hyponatremia. So after all, dilution effect is coming in both of them. Dilution is coming in both of them. And in any patient of SIADH, when you check the urine osmolality and the plasma osmolality, they'll always go opposite. I mean, all the water will come back in the body. So plasma osmolality will be less, like they might give you values like 250. And urine will be concentrated because all the water has gone back. All the water has been reabsorbed. So urine osmolality would be given to be 1000. So if you get a question in which urine osmolality and plasma osmolality are going in opposite directions, it is always a problem of antidiuretic hormone. No, doctor, sorbitrate does not prevent stroke. Sorbitrate is for treatment of chest pain. In any question, if you get opposite directions of urine and plasma osmolality, it's always gonna be antidiuretic hormone at work. And personally, I would like you to read about SIADH very thoroughly. The topic of SIADH I have given in kidney, not in endocrine, because it is compared with Bartter syndrome, Gitelman syndrome. Because there also there is problems of excessive urine output, like you get more water output in you get more urine output in diabetes insipidus. You also have problems in Bartter and Gitelman also. So read Bartter, Gitelman, diabetes insipidus, and SIADH together. And mostly in the exam, the important causes of important causes of SIADH that are given are not like carcinoid syndrome and stuff like that. They ask you CNS causes. So it could be like a person who's having a head injury. It could be meningitis, it could be encephalitis, it could be altered sensorium. So every time you are gonna be Gonna be getting a question with respect to CNS events, right? Starting from CNS event and then talking about urine and plasma osmolality going in opposite direction, SIADH is the one which you always have to be considered. Acid base status would be normal in SIADH talk. It would not be affected. No? Answer to question number 38 is alpha. Dr. Ramamurthy, it's not a discussion of any paper, it's a mock practice that we are doing here. So it could be for any exam. In case, I mean, you find it useful, you can use it for testing your reflexes at the moment or subsequently. Okay, yep. So Arup answered you very correctly by saying that whenever there is SIADH, there is no ABG derangement primarily present because proton causes problems with pH. Okay, coming to 39, which of the following will lead to development of malena? So obviously malena is upper GI bleeding. Malena is caused by, I'll put it like this, malena is an example of lower GI bleeding. Malena is technically a lower GI bleeding, but cause of malena is upper GI bleeding. So I think that should solve the answer for you. I repeat the fact once again, we read about hematochezia and malena together because both are lower GI bleed, but it is caused by upper GI bleed. So that will make it easier. The answer to this question would be beta myelorrhea syndrome. You would be having is a submucosal tear, right? The patient was having retching. There is a lower esophageal sphincter submucosal tear, and that will cause not only a upper GI bleed, but a blood due to gravity will also go down in the stomach. I mean, if a person is having a tear in the sphincter and in the cardia, I mean, the progression of the tear is from the LES to the cardia. Yes, and cardia, that's reverse peristalsis, and not only the patient will puke blood, but because of gravity, blood will obviously go into towards the pyloric end of the stomach and then into the small intestine, where it will be acted upon by the enzymes of the gut, and it will contribute to development of malena in the patient subsequently. Answer to 39 is B. Okay, coming to the next question. We are comparing the intestinal biopsy specimen of a patient before and after diet restriction. I mean, this itself should make the diagnosis very clear to you, because usually we go for diet restriction in the form of cereals being not allowed, especially bro cereals not being allowed for patients of celiac screw. So I mean, even if I don't rely on the pathology slide per se, I still can pick up the question is talking about celiac screw primarily. Now, when I cast a glance at the mucosa, you will notice that in the first image, there is a very classical blunting of the villi. And in the second image, you are noticing a regeneration of the villi. So that definitely, I mean, you can see the villi, you know, the projections which are present. So that makes it easier for you to comprehend the diagnosis and handle the case. The most common complication of celiac screw is development of cancer. Yes, most patients of celiac screw will develop a lymphoma. So don't answer infection, malabsorption, or I would say sepsis, or even I would say dehydration as a cause of death. I mean, yes, they do contribute to death, but it is lymphoma of the gut that would usually contribute to death. One of the sensitive tests that we do is a TTG, a tissue transglutaminase antibody test. For confirmation, it's obviously a biopsy. The ideal test is obviously a biopsy, but for screening, TTG test would be done. C says classic changes in the celiac screw occur in the submucosa. That's the aspect. The changes do not occur in the mucosa. Changes do not occur in the submucosa. I mean, where is the problem present? Problem is in the mucosa, na? Problem is not in the submucosa. Problem is in the mucosa. And you very well know that after 10 years of age, these patients would be having a development of dermatitis RPT formis. The answer to this MCQ is not A, as was answered by a couple of people. Guys, the leading cause of death in these patients is not infection, malabsorption, dehydration, bleeding, stuff like that. It is gut cancer. If you read option number C, what's the problem in option number C? It is written wrongly. Changes occur in the submucosa. That sub is sub word. Those three alphabets are changing the entire domain. The entire domain of the question. The answer to this question is option number Calcutta. The changes occur in the mucosa. Yes, EATL, enteropathy associated T-cell lymphomas can be seen. Okay, answer to 40 is C. As I explained, let's move on to the next one. 30-year-old patient has developed hemolytic uremic syndrome. You very well know that enterohemorrhagic E. coli can contribute to hemolytic uremic syndrome, and the lady underwent a dialysis. And the question says that what is the common complication of dialysis? We very well know the fact that in any patient with dialysis, Dr. Eva will be doing the NEET recall also very soon. I did it on Zoom yesterday. If maybe you were not present in the discussion, or maybe the notification did not come, but I have discussed it yesterday, Dr. Eva, in the Zoom group of PrepLadder, the NEET PG paper, and I'll put it on YouTube as well very soon. I mean, maybe by day after it would be on YouTube. Only some controversies are present. After listening to my discussion, you will realize that those controversies are primarily because the words or recall are the ones which are not matching properly. Okay, guys, coming back to the main aspect that we need to talk about. Any patient having undergoing dialysis, it is cardiovascular complications that will come, and the cardiovascular complication that can be seen is primarily hypotension. And in case I read about recurrent hemodialysis, if I modulate this question, like what is the leading complication that is seen with recurrent hemodialysis, then you will say it is accelerated atherosclerosis, and these patients can be having higher chances of cardiovascular mortality. The answer to this question is alpha. The bottom line is that CVS complications are the ones which are to be answered primarily. Okay, answer to 41 is alpha. Let's move on to 42. This is a 20-year-old patient. He presented with edema and decreased urine output. On evaluation, albumin is normal. So that's something, because normal albumin is around 2.5 to 3.5, here it's 3.5. So it's on the, I would say, upper limit of normal. That's a good thing. But the creatinine of the patient is deranged, and there are RBC casts. Protein is only 1 plus. And there is RBC casts which are present in this case. So that tells me the fact that what I am dealing with here is a case of glomerulonephritis. I'm definitely not dealing with nephrotic syndrome here, because two essentials of diagnosis of nephrotic are not present. In nephrotic, you should always be having two things. I mean, there should be three things, but at least two that should be demonstrated are hypoalbuminemia, albumin levels to be less than 2.5, and 4 plus or more than 3.5 grams proteinuria. So, I mean, this I hope will make it easier for you, because option number A and B are same. Minimal chain disease and lipoid nephrosis, they both mean the same, and they both are cause of nephrotic syndrome. IgA nephropathy or Berger disease will mainly present with, I mean, what is the point against Berger is, in Berger disease, the KFT of the patient is normal. In Berger disease, we usually do not have is the presence of any edema, and the urine output in the patient is also normal. Berger disease is one of the leading causes of hematuria. If the question says what is the leading cause of microscopic hematuria, then the leading cause of microscopic hematuria is IgA nephropathy. But point is that in Berger disease, patient is preserved. I mean, they don't come to you like a routine kidney disease patient. Berger disease ka patient kaise aata hai? Wo bolta, sir, urine changes color. Khansi zukam hua, he might have cough and cold. And after 2-3 days of cough and cold, then this person will be having is a change in the color of the urine. So most patients of Berger disease would not be the standard puffy eyes and swollen patient. I mean, kidney disease patients come to you all puffy, all swollen. Uski aankhe suji honge, haath mein sujan hai, paon mein sujan hai. I mean, he says clothes are not fitting and urine output is lesser. So edema is a manifestation that you get with CKD. But or with any kidney disease patient, but Berger disease primary problem is urine changing color, cola colored urine would be present in the patient. Everything else is normal. The diagnosis of this patient is option number delta, guys, nephritic syndrome. We cannot comment on the etiology of this chap because we really don't know. It could be post streptococcal glomerulonephritis. But the bottom line is, whenever you are having presence of hematuria with deranged kidney function, right, that's always to be thought of as glomerulonephritis, because hypertension is usually not a feature of nephrotic syndrome, and you don't get, I mean, RBC casts in nephrotic syndrome. Answer to 42 is delta. next live would be probably day after tomorrow for the NEET PG recall. Coming to question number 43 for today, which is not a feature of extrapyramidal lesion. So whenever you read about extrapyramidal, it means basal ganglia would be damaged. And the question is saying which of the following is not a feature. So when every time basal ganglia is damaged, there would be dystonia. in dystonia, like the neck could be turned to one side. You know, most of the time dystonia is seen after giving anti-vomiting injections. Like if you get a question in the exam in which a person has been given anti-vomiting drug like metoclopramide, right? And following injection of perinorm injection, no, in fact, I had to write the whole thing. I mean, lots of you would have given perinorm to vomiting patients. Pediatric patients mein perinorm doge to saath mein finargan de dena. Doctor round about the same time only, round about 7 o'clock. So whenever you give perinorm to any patient, it can cause basal ganglia manifestations. Chorea is also a feature of basal ganglia damage. It is always seen, whenever caudate nucleus is damaged, like Wilson disease. Then is absent superficial reflexes and normal deep tendon reflexes. To point out that absent superficial reflexes is a feature that you usually see with patients who are having lower motor neuron lesion. Deep tendon reflexes are normal in basal ganglia damage. I want to highlight this fact. Deep tendon reflexes are normal in myasthenia gravis. That is what we discussed in the earlier part of the discussion today. And remember, they're always normal in basal ganglia damage. That could be like Parkinsonism. The answer to this question is option number C, absent superficial reflexes, which are very classical for, like, you know, the table that you study, lower motor versus upper motor versus basal ganglia. And if you go to basics of neurology, there's a table. If you've not gone through that, I would suggest you to make a table by yourself. Compare the main points of lower motor versus upper motor versus basal ganglia versus cerebellar. Ek hi table banana. In that single table, in 1 minute, that should be 1 minute revision for you. Lower motor, upper motor, extrapyramidal and extrapyramidal with basal ganglia and cerebellar disease manifestations, all should be in a single page. And stick it on somewhere, because we read that from first year physiology and we tend to forget that. Okay, look, most of you are doing a great job, but still, I mean, if you're messing up on this one, do take care of the aspects that I'm saying. Coming to 44, he says, what's the usual presentation of SSPE? So this is a late complication of measles. Like at 2 years of age, this child in village had measles infection. SSP is seen in those patients where vaccine has not been given. Like this child, he lives in tribal India, deep jungles of Chhattisgarh, where like no health services can reach. And there are Maoists and there are terrorists. And I mean, people themselves are not so educated. So they think that vaccine nahi lagwana hai. So this is a child from deep jungles, tribal population of India, no education, no resources, no electricity, no water. And this child had measles. And at 8 years of age, he will develop damage to his brain. The measles virus will be damaging his brain per se. So in those circumstances, oh man, we are having spamming coming up. Okay, that's funny. What's the usual presentation of SSPE? Okay, Aisha came up with rash on the extremities. See, doctor, I'm not asking regarding presentation of measles per se. And pleomorphic rash is anyway a feature of chickenpox, no? Pleomorphic rash is a feature that you see with chickenpox primarily, no? It's not gonna be a manifestation of measles. SSP mein kya hota? It causes damage to the brain. It causes development of myoclonic jugs. If you read epilepsy, so the next message for you guys today is, for those of you who are listening to me, my request is 2 chapters, electrolytes imbalance, it's 1 hour 50 minutes, and epilepsy wala, again something like 1.5 hour. Do read them guys this week. That will help you reduce a lot of botheration in the exam time. The presentation of subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. The name is panencephalitis. There's damage to the brain, is development of myoclonic jerks in a patient. Option number D, you are able to rule out. Why? Because of the fact that this is a feature that you see with chickenpox. Meningismus is something that you see with, let me say, meningitis. I mean, nuchal rigidity, right? That's the alternative term for it. GTCS, तो यार GTCS तो इतनी बार बताया आपको, तो उसमें तो epilepsy है ना यार, generalized tonic-clonic grand mal epilepsy, that could be idiopathic also, or it could be secondary to let me say gross metabolic encephalopathy that could cause GTCS episode occasionally in a person or once in a while in a patient. Answer to 44 is option number alpha. Please read epilepsy wala component. Myoclonism kahan kahan padhte hain? So I'll just mention in short for those of you who are not interested in ki sir 1.5 hour kaun sunega. शॉर्ट में बता दो, तो शॉर्ट में ऐसे बता रहा हूँ, वर्ड्स मेरे ध्यान कर लेना। द फर्स्ट टाइम इन योर करियर यू विल रीड अबाउट मायोक्लोनिक जर्क्स इज गोना बी फॉर सलाम सीजर्स इन पीडियाट्रिक्स। दैट्स द ओनली हिंदी वर्ड इन मेडिकल लिटरेचर, और आई कैन पुट उर्दू वर्ड इन मेडिकल लिटरेचर, सलाम सीजर्स, दैट इज आई मीन ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज वेस्ट सिंड्रोम। सो यू विल रीड अबाउट द फार्माकोलॉजिस्ट सेइंग ACTH इंजेक्शंस आर यूजफुल फॉर मैनेजमेंट ऑफ वेस्ट सिंड्रोम। सो दैट्स द फर्स्ट एक्सपोजर ऑफ योर्स। सेकेंड इज SSPE, सब एक्यूट स्क्लेरोजिंग पैनेंसेफलाइटिस, देन इज जुवेनाइल मायोक्लोनिक एपिलेप्सी, एंड सेकेंड इज द लास्ट वन इज अ पर्सन हु इज ईटिंग पुअर क्वालिटी बीफ। दिस पर्सन इज गेटिंग इट मैड काउ डिजीज, सुना ना आप सबने मैड काउ डिजीज? तो फॉर नॉन मेडिकल पीपल इट इज मैड काउ डिजीज, बट लाइक द टंग ऑफ द काउ इट्स कंसिडर्ड टू बी डेलिकेसी, राइट? अब इंडिया में तो काउ इज ऑब्वियसली सेक्रेड, सो बट अब्रॉड लाइक दे ईट कैटल, दे ईट काउ, सो आई मीन सभी कुछ खा लेते हैं। सो वेन अ पर्सन इज कंज्यूमिंग पुअर क्वालिटी बीफ, दिस एनिमल वॉज इट सेल्फ इन्फेक्टेड, द एनिमल वॉज इट सेल्फ इन्फेक्टेड, द एनिमल शुड हैव बीन किल्ड, बट दे सोल्ड द मीट ऑफ दिस इन्फेक्टेड एनिमल इन ओपन मार्केट एंड द पर्सन इज कंज्यूमिंग इट, देन इन दो सर्कमस्टांसेस देर वुड बी आई मीन टेंटेड बीफ कंजम्पशन विल कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू दिस। द यूजल एज ऑफ प्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ सलाम सीजर्स विल बी इन द फर्स्ट ईयर ऑफ लाइफ। SSPE presents at 8 years of age. Yes, doctor, there's a definitive relation. Myoclonic jerks is the presentation of it. Juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, 10 to 19. Variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease is 30 years of age. So whenever you read like 30-year-old person having, I mean, a non-veg eater having myoclonic jerks, you should think in terms of VCJD. And these are some important differentials that I mentioned. I mean, myoclonic jerks, whenever you read these four differentials, should always come in your mind. Answer to question number 44 is alpha. Coming to question number 45 for today. A 70-year-old chap is having hemineglect and apraxia with hemiplegia, is having damage too. So when you read hemineglect and when you read about apraxia, it means the damage is to the non-dominant lobe. Apraxia would mean that in this case, he will not be able to draw geometrical shapes. Like if I draw these geometrical shapes before you, I can draw a triangle, I can draw a polygon, I can draw a star. I mean, a person who is having damage to the non-dominant part of the brain will always be having constructional apraxia. And when a person is having constructional apraxia, in those circumstances, I mean, you should be able to pick up that damage is very much present, non-dominant. I think I've solved half the MCQ for you. And the remaining thing you can solve on the basis of the fact that all these are tasks, I mean, like drawing geometrical shapes, visuospatial skills. I write that word. While I'm writing it, you can see that every alphabet has a different shape, right? So I can speak, I can talk, and I can write these alphabets because my visuospatial skills, that means I'm able to see what I'm writing. My brain is coordinating my hands. That visuospatial skills is a function of your parietal lobe. The answer to this question is option number delta. And with temporal lobe damage, I mean, whenever you read about temporal lobe damage, you know, the first thing that will always come to your mind would be funny things like deja vu, jamai vu. That is, either he will act as if he's very familiar or he's very unfamiliar with you, or he will have complex hallucinations where person will be having like a smell of rotten fish. वो बोलेगा कि वार्ड में देर इज सम डेड रैट, और लाइक नो बडी एल्स इन द वार्ड इज कंप्लेनिंग, बट दिस गाय स्मेलिंग अ बैड स्मेल ऑफ लाइक अ एनिमल, डेड एनिमल रॉटिंग, दैट वुड बी अ फीचर ऑफ आई मीन अ टेम्पोरल लोब डैमेज। आई एम जस्ट मेंशनिंग टेम्पोरल लोब, नॉट डोमिनेंट और नॉन डोमिनेंट, दिस दैट आई हाइलाइटेड इज प्राइमरली फॉर टेम्पोरल लोब डैमेज पर से। द आंसर टू दिस क्वेश्चन एनी वे वेल पिक्ड अप बाई एवरीबडी इज ऑप्शन नंबर सी। वी मूव टू द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन। He says which of the following is not included in the triad of normal pressure hydrocephalus. Quickly comment on the answer, guys, while I just write a quick mnemonic before you, and by this you will be able to remember this. In normal pressure hydrocephalus, the increased pressure will cause cortical atrophy. I mean, the ventricular system is expanded from within. No, the ventricular system is having CSF. When it will expand, it will press the brain tissue, so there will be cortical atrophy. Then in these patients, there will also be pressure on the cerebellum. This pressure on the cerebellum will explain ataxia, and because of pressure on the frontal lobe, there will be urinary incontinence. इसमें होता क्या है कि ये पार्ट्स ऑफ द ब्रेन प्रेस हो जाते हैं, Cortical atrophy due to pressure, cerebellum compressed due to pressure, frontal lobe compressed due to pressure. So the manifestations that occur are dementia, ataxia, and incontinence. What you will not have in this patient would be option number delta, that is aphasia. Two triads that I've highlighted before you are DAI and TBR, that's for Parkinsonism and normal pressure hydrocephalus per se. And the surprising thing is, in this case, the dementia component can also be reversible. So that's another aspect that I can add here. I mean, it looks very surprising when you read it, but then a reversible dementia will definitely be present here. In fact, agar aap inke lumbar puncture karke CSF nikal lete ho, no? That's an additional fact that I want to say. If you remove the CSF of this person, then the manifestations will reduce. The name itself is very paradoxical. Na? On one hand, I'm saying hydrocephalus, then I'm saying normal pressure. So most guys, when they read it for the first time, no, they are like, you know, doc, when we read this term, I mean, what do you mean by normal pressure? Hydrocephalus is always increasing pressure. But this is a term, I mean, this is a condition where the ventricles expand and the pressure is dissipated. Wo pressure normal kyun ho gaya? Because ventricles expand karke pressure ko dissipate kar lete. So wet, wacky, wobbly. Okay, the wacky would not exactly give you the sense of dementia. Yes, Dr. Prithviraj mentioned very correctly the Miller's test that I'm talking about, where we can remove the CSF of the patient and the neurological manifestations will become lesser. Answer to this one is delta. Good job. Let's move to the next one. Which of the following would not be included in features of vitamin B12 deficiency? Well, B12 deficiency will be seen in those people who don't eat non-vegetarian food. I repeat the fact once again. If a person is not eating vegetarian food, then it will cause folic acid deficiency. But if the person is not eating non-vegetarian food items, because B12 is present in food items, B12 is present in food items of animal origin. So it's non-veg food items that would be mainly, I mean, absent in the diet, which causes B12 deficiency. If you read a question which mainly says that person is not consuming green leafy vegetables, then green leafy vegetables not being consumed by the person would mainly contribute to folic acid deficiency. The question says which is not included in the features. I think I've given you sufficient lag period. In B12 deficiency, there will definitely be a sensory ataxia. In these patients, in fact, I can explain that better by saying that ataxia will come up because proprioception is lost, because the dorsal column of the spinal cord will be affected in this case. Upgoing plantars, why? Because corticospinal pathway would be affected. I repeat the fact once again, two important tracts which are affected in this condition is the corticospinal pathway and the dorsal column. Both of these are heavily myelinated tracts. So, kyunki sensory pathway heavily myelinated or motor pathway highly myelinated, dono hi affected ho gaye. That's why the term is combined demyelination of the spinal cord. Dorsal column is related to sensory and corticospinal related to motor. So both are getting affected. And corticospinal pathway damage again will explain the brisk reflexes also. But MCV of the patient will definitely be increased. The answer to this question is going to be given as option number C. Pseudotumor cerebri is a pediatric presentation. Doctor, it's not same as normal pressure hydrocephalus. It's not same as NPH. It is rather increase in pressure with normal ventricular side. Since you have put it up, I'll just highlight this. I mean, just a quick aspect here that came up, hydrocephalus. In hydrocephalus, what happens to the size and what happens to the pressure in the ventricle? So size also goes up, pressure also goes up. Then the pediatrician will talk about pseudotumor cerebri, vitamin A toxicity ke saath mein na. So pseudotumor cerebri ka khasiyat kya hoti hai? In pseudotumor cerebri, the size is normal, but the pressure is elevated. But in normal pressure hydrocephalus, what happens is that it is the size that is increased and pressure becomes dissipated. Please mark my words very carefully. Avinash put up an intelligent query there. Sir, is pseudotumor cerebri NPH same? No, buddy, it's not the same. These are the fundamental differences between the two. And once you get this imprinted in your brain, then you will be able to, you know, follow the disease subsequently relatively better. I hope it sorted out, Avinash, the query that you put up. Answer to 47 is option number C, and let's go to question number 48 now. Dr. Prithvi, I mentioned that in the app. Okay, This is a repeat one. You are the JR in the ICU. Senior doctor has asked you to manage a mechanically ventilated patient because in COVID, this is what was happening, that you will have to handle patients on ventilator. And simply that the ABG report showed that the patient is having respiratory acidosis. There is buildup of carbon dioxide in the body. So he says that what parameter will you change on the ventilator, which knob on the ventilator will you change so that you can improve the general condition of the patient. And I think due to some lag, I'm waiting for you guys to answer. Yes, I'll just slow down a bit because at my end, obviously things will run faster as compared to the time it they reach you. Yes. Whenever there is buildup of carbon dioxide in the body, what you should do is you should on the ventilator increase the respiratory rate. By increasing the respiratory rate, you will increase the minute volume of the patient and this will cause a carbon dioxide washout. But if oxygen in the body is lesser, but in case it is the oxygen in the body that is lesser, then you definitely can alter the FiO2 and you can also alter the PEEP. The correct answer for question number 48 is option number Bombay. In fact, both of these aspects have been highlighted in mechanical ventilation as well. So I want you to remember both these aspects. If it's a decrease of only oxygen in the body, in those circumstances, you would be obviously upgrading the FiO2 and the PEEP. And if it's going to be carbon dioxide increase, then you will have to upgrade the respiratory rate of the patient. I mean, two simple aspects, you know, there are three, four aspects which you need to be remembered. And my suggestion is that if you're having problem following this, what I've said, there's a small video on this YouTube channel of mine that is handling troubleshooting the ventilator. It's a short one. You can listen to it at 1.5x, but that troubleshooting, I mean, if you don't want to listen to the entire mechanical ventilation aspect that I've said, because you know, it becomes too much to remember ACMV, SIMV mode, or usually I don't think so in exam, they ask about ACMV, SIMV mode, though I've covered them. So they ask you very baseline data. So if you just want to touch the basics of ventilator, then I would suggest you to just listen to this, troubleshooting the ventilator part, which is present on the YouTube channel of mine, and you would be able to do it faster and would be able to have a higher strike rate in the exam, just in case you are short on time. I mean, if you want to read the whole thing, then you will have to listen, endure me for the entire duration for elective ventilation as well. Answer to 48 is Bombay. We've come to 49. It says an intern observed that the patient is unresponsive. The ECG was performed and showed that he is having an arrhythmia. So obviously we are talking about either a pulseless ventricular tachycardia or we are talking about ventricular fibrillation. The DC shock is delivered, but the arrhythmia is persisted. I mean, you know, this was the time when DC shock was delivered, but the arrhythmia and the patient is still persisting. In those circumstances, I mean, you need to take intervention, you need to act spot on. So the question says, what would you do next? Now, if I was at your age, you see, when I had not actually been to the wards, I thought that if one DC shock will not work, what you should do is you should give a second DC shock. But the point is, getting the machine to charge again will again take some time. So I will not wait for the machine to charge once again. What I will do is I will start the CPR in the patient once again. The correct answer to this question, as you have said very correctly, most of you have answered option number Bombay. I mean, if you're still answering A, as I can see in the chat, that's primarily because, you know, even when I was at your age, when I had not seen patients, I said, ek DC shock se theek nahi hua, dusra DC shock de do. But point is, you need to realize, and that's the protocol that I've also highlighted. This time I'm showing you the hand-drawn one. I mean, when you are delivering two DC shocks, between the DC shocks, no, it will take some time for the machine to actually work. So one team will be continuously using that opportunity to deliver CPR at 30:2, and a third person, that's why you have multiple people in the team whenever you have a crashing patient. So a third person will be rather securing a IV access inducer. Obviously, if you are short staffed, then all hell will break loose. But ideally, you should be having at least four people, one nurse and four including one nurse. So you are the team leader. You would be having one guy handling the airway, one guy giving chest compressions. They will keep on switching positions. And one person who's the nurse, she will put in the IV cannula and she will be giving IV medication. Or like, you know, in between, you can ask the nurse to secure the airway, and one of the doctors can put in IV cannula, because nurses sometimes, you know, they are like, I mean, mostly nurses don't work and interns only put IV cannula. So you would be much more skilled than obviously a nurse to get the IV line in place, or you can use an intraosseous access also. But as I highlighted, guys, this basic protocol that I mentioned for basic life support, do cram this. This should be having, you should be having a photographic memory in your mind regarding this. And if you have not been able to retain it, then what you should do is note it down the way I have and stick it on somewhere and keep on watching it as many times, or keep on reading it as many times as you can, so that you would be able to solve questions related to it. Okay, answer to 49 is Bombay, and they love to ask these kind of scenarios. That's the same table that I'm talking about. I showed you that earlier also, and I hope it's clear from today's discussion that epinephrine is gonna be given in both scenarios. Dono mein dete hain, reasons are different. In person having cardiac arrest, you give epinephrine to stimulate the SA node on the left hand side to improve coronary perfusion, kyunki vasoconstrictor hai. Okay. Then one question on GCS is always asked. It would be, I would say, harakiri, as they say in Japanese, harakiri for a doctor to go into the exam without remembering the aspects related to GCS. For learning the GCS part, I know you will give the answer to this question, no issues. But if you are reading this question and you are having difficulty in remembering, I'll obviously mark it on the table. But what I want you to do is, how many cycles of CPR? Dr. Pooja, there's no limit on the number of CPR cycles and adrenaline that can be given. It depends on case to case basis. Like in Indira Gandhi's case, who was shot by her own bodyguards, more than 1000 vials of adrenaline. Yes, I'm not joking. This is reality. More than 1000 vials of adrenaline were used, right? How many of them were actually effective, or whether they actually caused something, we really don't know. And they gave CPR for hours altogether. So I would say if it's like a VVIP and it's a prime minister of a country, and the person has been shot and the person is having a flatline ECG, I will try for hours to revive, because obviously, a VVIP from a country's perspective, you gotta do as much as you can. But if I have a patient who's like 90 years of age, who's already having prostate cancer, I will leave resuscitation after 15 to 20 minutes. So most of the time we definitely follow all these steps, because following all these steps will take some time. So there is no upper limit of how many cycles are to be given. It depends on case to case basis. It depends on the doctor's jurisdiction. Coming back to the agenda, I'm still having issues with respect to this question. So I first want to say that if you read it carefully, the person is opening eye to pain. So how would you give this pain? You are gonna press with your thumb on the supraorbital notch, or you can press with your finger on the nail bed of the person hard, and the person is opening eyes to pain. So you would be giving 2 points for it. I'll just zoom it in for your convenience. I hope it's visible now. You should not be pressing on the supraorbital notch of the patient, though we all do that, because that gives a very bad impression to the relatives sitting that you are trying to give pain. Then lot of us do this activity, rub knuckles on the sternum of the patient. That's again something which looks very, imagine, your own loved one is lying unresponsive and the doctor is rubbing the sternum. It would not look good. So ideally they say press on the nail bed of the person. You can use a backside of your ballpoint pen, the cap, and press hard with that cap on the, if you're not physically very, well built and it's difficult to press, just use that to press on the nail bed and you'd be able to get the response. Now most chaps, they find problem with verbal response, so inappropriate responses, isme P alphabet 3 bar aata hai, so that helps you in picking up that would be 3. Obviously you need to remember the entire details, but I have usually found that people are not able to work out details with respect to 3 and 2. Inappropriate words means that I said to the patient, what is your name, and wo mujhe gaali de raha hai, right? Gali there, right? And on the other hand, if I say to the patient, tell me your phone number, what is your name, and the patient is mumbling, ही बोल रहा है मुझे समझ नहीं आ रही. एक में वन आई कुड अंडरस्टैंड, गाली दे रहा है, ही इज अब्यूजिंग मी, आई कुड पिक इट अप. सेकेंड, द चैप इज मम्बलिंग, सो देयर इज अ डिफरेंस बिटवीन द टू. सो थ्री इज गोना बी व्हेन यू कांट मेक आउट व्हाट ही इज सेइंग, द नर्स कांट मेक आउट व्हाट ही इज सेइंग, मम्बलिंग, दैट इज 2 मार्क्स. सो दैट्स अ पॉइंट दैट वी टेंड टू मेस अप. एंड देन मोस्ट गाइज मेस अप बिटवीन फ्लेक्शन वर्सेज एबनॉर्मल फ्लेक्शन एंड देन एक्सटेंशन. दैट्स द स्कोर्स. If you want to be more comfortable with these, because this is obviously a quick discussion, in the clinical part, I have demonstrated this on a patient, real time patient. So please listen to glaucoma scale in that video in the integrated essentials part, and you will be able to solve it relatively better. The question said abnormal flexion, so that will make it easier for you to work out. People said A versus B. Then the answer came out to be B because. Obviously, the table was visible much better. But Glasgow Coma Scale is something that I find people making a lot of errors also. So please do take care of, GCS question should never go wrong under any circumstances. Yes, mumbling would be having 2M. That's another input Avinash gave in. That's a good pickup. Okay. In question number 51, let's see who gives the answer the fastest. pH is lesser, PCO2 is elevated, both are going in opposite direction, so it's a respiratory problem. It's obviously a respiratory acidosis. Now I need to see whether it is compensated or non-compensated, because if bicarbonate will be normal, then it will be uncompensated, and if it is elevated, it will be partially compensated. So you very well can see in the question, the bicarbonate value here is normal, that means compensation has not started. Yes, guys, can I have the answer? In question number 51, please understand the fact that because arrows are going in opposite direction, it is definitely a respiratory acidosis. But because bicarbonate in the patient at the moment is normal, then we're going to call it a uncompensated respiratory acidosis. The answer to this question, okay. I had various inputs here for this question. Couple of guys have got it correct also. But then for people saying partially compensated, so partially compensated tab bolenge na jab bicarbonate ki value bad jati hai. Like in this MCQ, bicarbonate was 28. Then answer B would have been valid because the kidney is trying to neutralize the acidosis. For people saying C, wo to answer nahi ho sakta kyunki fully compensated ke liye to pH normal hona chahiye na. Sir, option number C will never ever be given to you in the exam unless and until the examiner has made a hell-bent decision of, ensuring that you are not able to correct the question. Agar pH normal hai, to either iska matlab hai generally normal hai or it is fully compensated. Na? Fully compensated scenarios are never given in the exam. So either they give you, most of the exams, either they give you uncompensated or they give you partially compensated. And how the differentiation is made is on the basis of value of bicarbonate. There are 2 videos on ABG, worth the effort, spend some time on them and you would be able to get these questions right. They're very simple, very straightforward. Even if you listen to them at fast speed, you will be able to understand that. ABG, sir, is very easy. Most of us doctors, we are bad at chemistry and physics and we took a biology na. So we might have done physics, chemistry, average. So most of the guys, they fumble with ABG, not because of the fact that, being a doctor, it's difficult. It's very easy. Nurses are able to do a better job than us because they say that on a regular basis. Anything that you do regularly, you will be able to do better. Answer to 51 is option number A. Every exam in India, assure you, next NEET FMG will be having ABG questions, at least 2 to 3. Since they have changed the pattern in FMG, ABG questions are coming. NEET exam mein toh dekh lo abhi, is baar ka jo abhi NEET hua hai, usme 4 bhi nahi, I think some people are saying 6 the, I'm not sure. 4 toh mujhe mile hai, So there were 4 ABG questions yaar. Toh aapke MC exam mein ABG pucha usne, abhi NEET mein 4 ABG pucha. Toh this is an integral part which is, should be remembered sir, should be remembered definitely. Yep. No doc, it's not a mastery. We still need to practice more. So it's just that we should be able to crack those questions. Okay, answer to 51 is alpha. Good job. आई होप गाइज दोज हु हैव आंसर्ड बी फॉर दिस वन, एक बार प्लीज देख लेना ये कॉम्पोजिट और अनकॉम्पोजिट का फंडा जो है, डिफरेंस यही है बाइकार्बेट की वैल्यू जो होती है एक में बढ़ जाती है और एक में वो इंक्रीज, सर 22 से 26 ले रहे होते हैं सर, देवर सिक्स क्वेश्चंस अभिषेक सर, ओके नहीं नहीं सर स्वरूप दैट वुड बी टू नैरो रेंज ना, 24 तो हम एवरेज लेते हैं यार, पूजा से सिक्स क्वेश्चंस आई नीड, तो पूछ रहा है यार ही इज आस्किंग, मतलब सारे एग्जाम में ही पूछ रहा है, तो उसको कर लेंगे जितना कर लेंगे उतना इजी हो जाता है एग्जाम में, इट्स अ सिंपल टॉपिक ऐसा कुछ है नहीं, वो मतलब हाइप क्रिएट करी हुई है पुराने टाइम से, हाइप है कि यार एबीजी डिफिकल्ट होता है, एबीजी समझ नहीं आता, बहुत स्कोरिंग है सर बहुत स्कोरिंग है, आपका रैंक डेफिनेटली इंप्रूव हो जाएगा अगर आपने एबीजी वाले क्वेश्चन सॉल्व किए तो, ओके जी आंसर टू 51 इज अल्फा, फॉर माई बॉयज वो लिसनिंग प्लीज रिमेंबर दैट ए एंड बी थिंग, इफ यू मेस्ट अप राइट डू डू हैव अ लुक एट द एबीजी पार्ट, ओके कमिंग टू 52, 22-year-old boy presents with recurrent falls with difficulty in ambulation. So, neurology-based question. Atrophied leg muscles are noticed. I mean, that's the key word which is to be remembered because traditionally, whenever you read about a boy and he's having falls, we think in terms of Duchenne's muscular dystrophy. Duchenne's muscular dystrophy is genetically oriented, I mean, genetically inherited. It is X-linked recessive. Now, यस यस डॉक्टर हमजा दैट वॉज दैट स्पैजम वाला ना, यप फाइन फाइन ग्रेट ओके लेट्स लेट्स फोकस ऑन द जॉब एट हैंड, यस थैंक्स डॉक्टर फॉर द इनपुट आकाश, इन दिस केस व्हेन यू रीड अबाउट डुशनीज मस्कुलर डिस्ट्रॉफी यू ऑलवेज हैव दैट सूडो हाइपरट्रॉफी ऑफ द काफ मसल्स, बट इन दिस पर्टिकुलर केस देर इज अट्रोफिड लेग मसल्स, so the answer will not be Duchenne's muscular dystrophy. Another reason why Duchenne's muscular dystrophy will not be the answer is because the usual age of presentation is mostly between 4 to 10 years of age, and after 10 years of age most patients will become wheelchair bound. I mean a Duchenne's patient at 20 years of age, 22 years of age, he will not be able to walk, he will not be able to even get out from a chair, agar usko washroom bhi jana hai to parents will have to pick up, imagine the trauma, full एल्डर सन उसको उठा के व्हीलचेयर से टॉयलेट सीट पे बिठाना पड़ेगा उसको, क्यों खुद से वो उठ ही नहीं पाएगा, हिप जॉइंट के मसल्स में वीकनेस होता है, सो पेशेंट्स ऑफ डुशनीज मस्कुलर डिस्ट्रॉफी में पेशेंट 22 साल पे व्हीलचेयर बाउंड हो जाएगा, दो आई थिंक मेजोरिटी पीपल आर कमेंटेड ऑन द डायग्नोसिस ऑल्सो, आई वॉन्ट हाईलाइट आई मीन इफ दे गिव यू द ट्रेडिशनल क्वेश्चन ऑफ सूडो हाइपरट्रॉफी ऑफ द काफ मसल्स देन ग्रेट इट इज डुशनीज मस्कुलर डिस्ट्रॉफी इफ द प्रेजेंटेशन इज बिटवीन 4 to 10 ईयर्स ऑफ एज and the CPK MM levels are elevated. If the age group of the patient is between 10 to 20 years of age, it's still a boy, both scenarios, and CPK MM is elevated, then it is Becker's muscular dystrophy. Both are variants of each other, both are inherited. But in our case, we were noticing a very classical peroneal muscle atrophy. This is a feature of an inherited neuropathy. And that inherited neuropathy is what is called as Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease. The answer to question number 52 that we're discussing at the moment is option number Bombay. Doc, gene therapy is what is being used for management of these patients. There's no definitive treatment. We use steroids, but as such, I mean, apart from gene therapy and steroids, nothing else will work here. Answer to 52 is Bombay, and why it is not C, congenital myopathy, because congenital myopathy then will cause symptoms early on. It will not wait till 22 years of age. हाँ बट वो स्टेरॉइड्स के अपने साइड इफेक्ट्स भी है ना, ज्यादा दोगे तो इट कॉजेज, स्टेरॉइड्स खुद भी तो मायोपैथी करते हैं ना, तो आई हैव सीन स्टेरॉइड अब्यूज से उसका ना पूरा फेस पफी हो जाता है एंड द चाइल्ड बिकम्स मोर वेस्टेड. Congenital myopathy will be having manifestations since birth, and the answer to this question, anyway, is Charcot-Marie-Tooth. Coming to 53, a 5-year-old boy has ultra flexible fingers and can even touch the back of the hand with wrist extended. No, if I extend my wrist at the moment, I mean, there's a limit to how much I can extend. There's a limitation to the extension. But in this case, I mean, this is what I'm saying. The patient is having hyperextensible joints and a very flexible skin as well. Now, had I written the word rubber man, had I said the word flexible, then obviously, I mean, it would have been a little easier for you to crack. So I, in fact, in this image showed you very classical image that would help you in diagnosis of this, that is Ehlers-Danlos. And in fact, somebody asked for tips for the FMG exam. This is what they asked, but this is last time's paper only that they had put up this question. So Avinash, there would be contractures in the foot. There would be cardiac involvement possibly present. There would be thicker nerves, onion bulb, onion ring appearance of the nerves that would be present in that congenital myopathy of Ehlers-Danlos. Okay. Answer to 53 is delta. It's just that instead of mentioning regarding rubber man or instead of mentioning regarding that flexibility in the skin, the question mentioned regarding hyperextensible joints. Okay, and in Marfan syndrome, I mean, we have, you know, a very tall person, arm span is more than height, ectopia lentis would be mentioned. So you would be, I mean, why not Alport syndrome? Because there would be ESRD, you know, in Marfan and because obviously there's hematuria, there is deafness. A lot of things that come up, lenticonus that would come up. So you are anyway able to anterior lenticonus. A here means anterior lenticonus. So I mean the other aspects are anyway to be looked up. And Marfan will classically present with yes, aortic root dilatation, mitral valve prolapse in a patient. Okay, moving to the next one. Calcium metabolism, they again love to ask about it. The only difference is that in FMG they will ask you vitamin D deficiency, in PG entrance they will ask you hypophosphatemic rickets, which is occurring due to FEX gene. There's a phosphate wasting. Simple सा बंदा है, मतलब हमेशा देखोगे तो vitamin D deficiency rickets और hypophosphate कम है, hypophosphatemic rickets due to FEX gene. They love to ask that. तो जी पहले हम पढ़ते हैं vitamin D deficiency rickets में क्या होगा. तो obviously in this condition dietary supplements of vitamin D3 is less, so calcium will be less. Now, due to calcium, what will happen to PTH? PTH will increase because PTH responds to calcium. And when PTH will increase, what PTH does on the kidney is PTH causes a phosphate loss. Phosphate loss. So phosphate is less in hypophosphatemic rickets, but in hypophosphatemic rickets, mein calcium normal hota hai. I repeat the fact once again. If he gives you MCQ, जिसमें calcium normal है, phosphate कम है, it is hypophosphatemic rickets. पर अगर दोनों ही कम-कम जा रहे हैं, then it is the traditional vitamin D deficiency which is present. The correct answer for this MCQ. Yes, guys, I think the answer will be Bombay. Yep, very good. So pretty a straightforward one. You can work it out easily. Okay, coming to 55. This time I did not get into the nitty-gritties. Yes, Stoss therapy would be required. Stoss therapy basically means 6 lakh international units of vitamin D3. That's itself a name or is itself an MCQ. Stoss therapy is used in vitamin D deficiency rickets. That would be vitamin D3, 6 lakhs. You obviously can give sachets also available, but that when you are giving mega dosages, that's when Stoss therapy is asked. So do remember that question itself, what Avinash pointed. Okay, moving to 55. A 50-year-old patient comes with complaints of fatigue, limb weakness in the evening, and his symptoms are improved after administration of Edrofonium. What is the most probable diagnosis of this patient? So the moment you read about Edrofonium causing improvement, you know that the diagnosis of the patient is myasthenia gravis. And I did not even feel like asking you this one because this is a pretty spotter, easily picked up. And compare that with Lambert-Eaton, the previous MCQ, I did find people making errors. Okay, जी. So this is just to increase your scores. The next one says, which of the following is correct about definition of steroid-resistant nephrotic syndrome? So we all read about it. We all love to say that tacrolimus is useful or sirolimus. In fact, sirolimus first, less nephrotoxic. We all read about sirolimus or mTOR inhibitors being useful for management of steroid-responsive, steroid-resistant nephrotic syndrome. But at the moment, it is the definition which is mentioned here. The previous one was different from this one, doctor for myasthenia gravis. Yes, guys, waiting for answer for you guys. So normally in nephrotic syndrome, especially the minimal change disease variety, we give steroids for 8 weeks, but we are not going to wait for, I mean, you see, we're not gonna wait for a person to, develop or continue with proteinuria for a very long duration. I mean, the point is, when I say resistant nephrotic syndrome, it means that I've given steroids, but the proteinuria is still continuing. Usually within 3 days, upper limit of 2 weeks, the proteinuria decreases from 4+ to 1+ and practically disappears. The question here says, which of the following would be the best definition or correct about the definition of this? Now, obviously, there are various definitions which are present, but then let me have it from you guys. I mean, yes, guys, 56, please. Okay. No, Rahul, that is what I was trying to say now, that you are not going to wait for the entire 8 week duration. I mean, I'm ruling out option C right away, because in minimal change disease, we are gonna give it for 8 weeks. But I'm not gonna wait for 8 weeks and say, okay, this is steroid resistant. I need to have a earlier setup. So in those circumstances, doc in clinical stem, no, there would be normal calcium with low phosphate, as I mentioned. I mean, if you're talking about the नीट पीजी वाला क्वेश्चन है, उसमें कैल्शियम 11 था या 10 था शायद, और फास्फेट बहुत लो था, तो वो एक बहुत ही इजी इंडिकेटर था कि वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट हाइपोफॉस्फेटेमिक रिकेट. ओके, यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट डिपेंडेंट रिकेट्स. नो डॉक, फॉर डिपेंडेंट रिकेट्स आई विल डेफिनेटली रिक्वायर विटामिन डी3 वैल्यूज आल्सो, बट इफ यू वांट टू पिक अप न्यूट्रिशनल रिकेट्स फ्रॉम हाइपोफॉस्फेटेमिक, दैट कैल्शियम फॉस्फेट वैल्यूज विल डू इट फॉर यू. बट फॉर डिपेंडेंट रिकेट्स यू नीड वैल्यूज ऑफ विटामिन डी ऑल्सो, नो, बिकॉज देर कुड बी एंड ऑर्गन रेजिस्टेंस, सो दैट वैल्यूज ऑफ विटामिन डी विल डेफिनेटली हेल्प यू इन ट्रिकिंग और सॉल्विंग दिस क्वेश्चन. Okay, so I've given sufficient time for solving this question. I had varied responses. The best answer for question number 56 would be alpha, that is absence of remission for at least 4 weeks. I mean, definition of remission is that for 3 consecutive days there's no proteinuria present in the patient, but we're gonna wait. I mean, point is, I'm not gonna wait very long. Very long means for 2 months to decide, okay, he's not responding. I would like to have a shorter cutoff for the same. Answer to 56 is alpha. We come to 57 for today. This is again a pattern that you will notice in all the exams coming up in India, that they'll give you a CNS case of meningitis and they'll expect you to pick up the CSF findings of the patient. So let's go through this one. You have a 45-year-old lady. She's having irritability and drowsiness for 2 weeks. So unlikely to be acute bacterial meningitis, because that will usually have history of days. She was complaining of headache for fairly long. The GCS is on the lower side and there's a nuchal rigidity. I mean, the moment I looked at the stem of the question, I could pick up nuchal rigidity words. So मतलब मुझे लग गया यार meningitis का सवाल आ गया. LP was performed, it is showing lymphocytosis. Now, in an Indian exam, whenever you read lymphocytosis, first thought process should always be tubercular meningitis. The next possibility that is to be kept is obviously viral meningitis. I repeat the fact once again, both tubercular meningitis and viral meningitis are to be considered. Tubercular meningitis will have a longer history, viral meningitis will have a shorter history, and more and above this, in tubercular meningitis, the CSF sugar values will dramatically be reduced or at least lesser. But when it comes to viral, the CSF sugar of the patient will be normal. So if you look at the question in this particular case, what you're noticing is it's a longer history of 2 weeks. Then the sugar is definitely on the lower side. I mean, normal CSF sugar is 2/3 of the blood sugar. So suppose if your ever average blood sugar is 100, average, I'm saying 90, 100, then your CSF sugar should be something in the range of about 60, 60, 66. But here it is 54. So because the sugar in the CSF is less and proteins are grossly elevated, normal protein in the CSF is 15 to 45 milligram percent. Here you can notice that the protein is very high, about 3 gram percent. So this definitely goes in favor of tubercular meningitis, and I'll be starting the person on anti-tubercular drugs. The answer to this question is Bombay. If this question had a shorter history, if it had normal CSF sugar, if it was having mild increase in values of proteins, I would have been more comfortable thinking in terms of a meningoencephalitis or maybe a viral meningitis in the case. But considering the amount of information given, we have to think in terms of antitubercular treatment for this patient. I still got inputs as C, guys. Acyclovir is given for viral encephalitis. And most of the time it is meningoencephalitis, and this is not a herpes meningoencephalitis that has occurred in the patient. Why? Because CSF sugar in this case is reduced. Proteins are grossly elevated. In fact, the proteins in this case are, I would say, almost, if mathematically I look at it, 45 ka main increase karu, to something in the range of about 7 to 8 times increase. 8 times, no? 8 would be like almost 7 to 8 times increase of CSF protein is present. So that gross protein increase, cobweb coagulum wala situation ho jaye, kyunki itna protein hoga tabhi to clot banega. The main highlight of this MCQ is long history, and Doc Avinash point is CSF sugar will depend on the blood sugar, and because random blood sugar of this patient is not given, because every time you have to comment on low CSF sugar, your point is right, every time you have to comment on the CSF sugar, you must have a random blood sugar. Now I am assuming random blood sugar, so I did not make only CSF sugar as I would say the fulcrum or as the only point for diagnosis. I said, considering the long history, considering the gross elevation of protein, if I look at it in the entire range, so don't focus on 55 to 60, those are the comments that are coming up, don't focus on that mathematical value alone, look at it from the entire domain. It is tubercular meningitis, and I'll put it like this, in an Indian exam, CSF lymphocytosis is always tubercular meningitis till proved otherwise. We always empirically start ATT. आपने देखा होगा बहुत बार तो ceftriaxone start कर देते हैं, उसके बाद उसका ATT शुरू हो जाता है, हम antiviral तक दे देते हैं. Right, though that's far-fetched, I would say, but you would have lots of time both in your pediatrics and medicine unit seen ceftriaxone and ATT going in the same patient together. Because we are not very sure, because tubercular meningitis is so common in India that tubercular meningitis in India can present as acute bacterial meningitis also. It's not a necessity that in tubercular meningitis only lymphocytes will be present. Even in tubercular meningitis in the first week you have neutrophils. The answer to this question is Bombay, guys. I mean CSF. Remember my words. You know, उससे आपको clarity आ जाएगी क्योंकि हम word में routine लिए करते हैं. Empirical ATT treatment start कर रहे होते हैं. Yes, empirical word written Harrison में है. Don't be under impression that only in India consultants are asking you कि भाई tubercular meningitis हो सकता है. Harrison में लिखा है कि don't waste for PCR CSF, don't waste for PCR herpes simplex. आप empirical grounds पे, क्योंकि report आने में time लगेगा. तो yes, definitely हम उसको empirical ATT start कर सकते हैं. And steroids क्यों देते हैं? अविनाश ने point raise किया. Steroid देते हैं यहाँ पर क्योंकि it will enhance the penetration of the drugs into the CSF. इनफैक्ट मैं नर्स को ये बोलूंगा कि स्टेरॉइड का इंजेक्शन लगाने से पहले, आई मीन एंटीबायोटिक पहले देना है, स्टेरॉइड देना है, तो मैं उसको बोलूंगा कि स्टेरॉइड का इंजेक्शन सपोज 8 o'clock को लगना है, सो गिव सॉरी अगर एंटीबायोटिक का शॉट 8 PM पे लगना है, तो आई विल टेल द नर्स टू गिव स्टेरॉइड इंजेक्शन एट 7:30. सो इफ यू गिव स्टेरॉइड हाफ एन आवर टू 1 hour बिफोर, इट विल एनहांस द पेनिट्रेशन ATT ड्रग्स का, खासकर बिकॉज ATT ड्रग्स हैव लिमिटेड पेनिट्रेशन. नाउ यू विल गिव देम बाय एनजी ट्यूब. पेशेंट इज सिक, पेशेंट इज लेथार्जिक, patient is having meningitis, I'm not comfortable giving oral tablet to the patient, he or she might aspirate and die, so I'll give it by NG tube. And ATT drugs have limited penetration into the CSF, so we usually give steroids to enhance the penetration. Okay, coming to 58. In acute bacterial meningitis, there will be neutrophils and CSF sugar will almost be zero, Mohit. I mean, every time I say neutrophils present in CSF, zero sugar CSF, that would be ABM. And history would be few days. Okay, guys, let's move on to 58. This says patient with bloody diarrhea. Doctor has diagnosed him as shigellosis. And what clinical feature made him to choose shigella over cholera? So obviously one was blood in the stool. But over and above this, whenever there is a dysentery, no, Rahul, it's not going to be vomiting. I mean, vomiting is not going to decide what is the etiology. Whenever I say dysentery, okay, I'm getting varied responses. Guys, what is the definition of dysentery? Definition of dysentery is fever with blood in the stools. You do not have presence of fever in cholera. You only have watery stools. Whenever you read dysentery, no? I mean, I have deliberately not written the word dysentery because then it will make easier for you. But dysentery, zaruri nahi ki dysentery mein loose motion hota hai yaar. Initial presentation of dysentery will be having fever with blood in the stool. So you need to look at it from the objective. K कि भाई इसको फीवर था इसलिए मैं इसको डायसेंट्री डायग्नोज कर रहा हूँ, डायरिया नहीं बोल रहा हूँ, क्योंकि डायरिया इज लूज मोशन, मे नॉट बी अ फीचर। सी गाइस, क्रैम्पी एब्डोमिनल पेन तो जियार्डिया में भी होती है ना, आई मीन कैंपर्स डायरिया जियार्डियास इज ऑल्सो कॉज एब्डोमिनल पेन, सो इट्स नॉट एब्डोमिनल पेन और वॉमिटिंग दैट विल कॉज इट। एंड रेक्टल पेन तो यार बड़ा नॉन स्पेसिफिक है ना, पेशेंट तो बोलेगा नहीं कि भाई रेक्टम में पेन हो रही है ना। आई मीन रेक्टल पेन तो इज अ टर्म विच इज जस्ट अ डमी चॉइस इन द क्वेश्चन जस्ट टू थ्रो यू ऑफ द ट्रैक। भाई रेक्टल पेन पेशेंट थोड़ी ना बोलेगा मुझे रेक्टल पेन है। आंसर टू 58 इज ऑप्शन नंबर सी। ओके सी अविनाश, टेनेस्मस इज डिफरेंट फ्रॉम क्रैम्पी एब्डोमिनल पेन। टेनेस्मस इज इनकम्प्लीट इवैक्यूएशन, वेयर एज क्रैम्पी एब्डोमिनल पेन इज अ डिफरेंट फैक्ट। क्रैम्पी एब्डोमिनल पेन इज प्रेजेंट विद एवरी एपिसोड ऑफ जीआई अपसेट, है ना। फूड पॉइजनिंग में भी क्रैम्पी पेन हो सकता है, लूज मोशन ड्यू टू कॉलरा में भी हो सकता है, एंड डायसेंट्री में भी हो सकता है। सो क्रैम्पी एब्डोमिनल पेन इज प्रेजेंट इन एवरी जीआई अपसेट, दैट्स नॉट अ डिफरेंशिएटिंग फीचर। बट वेन यू रीड द डेफिनेशन ऑफ वर्ड डायसेंट्री, वट कम्स अप इज ऑब्वियसली प्रेजेंस ऑफ फीवर। आंसर इज सी। आई न्यू यू विल आर्ग्यू फॉर दिस क्वेश्चन विद मी, आई न्यू दैट। ओके लेट्स मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट वन। A 60-year-old patient with low back pain and sclerotic lesions in the vertebra. The question says, what is the possible etiology? With breast cancer, we mainly will be having osteoblastic secondaries. The question says osteolytic. For multiple myeloma, it is lytic lesions which are present. So the traditional answers will not work in this case. I think I've given you sufficient time for answer. Can I have the inputs, please, for 59? No, doc. Absolutely. Good. Very good, Anupam. Yep, Dr. Rishi, you got it spot on. It is osteosclerotic lesions. Osteosclerotic lesions are seen with prostate cancer. Yes, the answer is Bombay. Guys, at some point I have highlighted this osteolytic versus osteoblastic versus osteosclerotic. Traditional osteolytic lesions are seen with the follicular cancer. In fact, I'll just write it over this one also. Renal cell cancer, then you also read about follicular cancer of thyroid, where you also read about pulsatile mets, renal cell carcinoma. So these are the traditional scenarios where you read about lytic lesions versus osteoblastic is breast cancer, but sclerotic is prostate cancer. Answer to the question that I put up before you is Bombay. Good job. Coming to 60, which of the following condition will lead to development of a wing beating tremor? So just remember the W alphabet coming up here. Wing beating tremor is a feature that you see with, yes, hepatolenticular degeneration. Sufficient hints given, sufficient time lag given to you guys. Can I have the answer, please? Yes, guys. Absolutely, guys. That would be Wilson disease. I think there was a time lag or some internet connection that became slow. So maybe your inputs came a little later. But I think this is a spotter. This can be picked up immediately. I mean, the moment you read this, no tricks in this question per se. Answer to question number 60 C. So now, since you're getting questions correct, I think you would agree that it's a balanced paper and not all the questions are twisted. Okay, let's move on to the next one. A female patient presented with malar rashes and fever and was having vegetations on either sides of the heart valves. So when you read malar rashes, you obviously are talking about SLE and you're talking about Lippmann Sachs endocarditis. The answer to 61 is option number B. Yeps. Standard presentation of SLE, Lippmann Sachs endocarditis can be having vegetations on either sides of the valves. Most of the patients of this condition would be asymptomatic. But if he says to you which valvular lesion would be developing in these patients, then it is mitral regurgitation. If person is asymptomatic, no treatment would be required. But if it is mitral regurgitation, then valvuloplasty would be required for management of these patients. So if he says valvular lesion, then definitely answer valvuloplasty. If it is asymptomatic, then no treatment would be required. Okay. Moving to the next one. A patient has been admitted to the intensive care unit since he's having fever for past 4 days with new onset breathlessness. When I read fever and breathlessness, I'm thinking in terms of COVID-19 pneumonia. This would be the number one differential in the current scenario. I'm noticing that the patient is unresponsive to the incremental flow rate. So that means FiO2 is being increased by the doctor. You are giving high concentration of oxygen. Yes, MSB hota Avinash, but then MR is more common. But oxygen saturation of the patient is still falling. That means he has gone into ARDS. In acute respiratory distress syndrome, we have refractory hypoxia. In fact, one of the very common statements that I have made for ARDS is, one is my left atrial pressure is always normal. And after mentioning that left atrial pressure is normal, because I wanted to teach you that this is a non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, I wanted to highlight the fact that patient is gone into, I mean, acute respiratory distress syndrome. Mediastinitis to isme nahi hai because there's no rupture of the esophagus. Pulmonary fibrosis will be having long history. And atelectasis, yes, possible in a bedridden patient. But then most of the time in atelectasis, you will notice that chest physiotherapy and supplemental oxygen works. If atelectasis has occurred due to supine position of the patient, turning the patient, chest physiotherapy, and increasing FiO2 usually works. But in case the patient has gone a downhill course, then the bad news is that he's gone into acute respiratory distress syndrome. Answer to 62 is option number C. Coming to the next one. A 50-year-old patient working in a sugarcane facility has presented with breathlessness and fatigability. The respiratory rate is on the higher side. I mean, you and me would be breathing 10 to 12 times per minute. It's 20 times per minute with accessory muscles or respiration. So respiratory distress is present in the patient. Crepitations are also heard in the chest of this guy. And he says, which of the following is responsible? So can I have a quick diagnosis or input for question number 63, please? Yeah, Dr. Pooja, atelectasis is post-operative. It can occur, I mean, in any bedridden patient also, but I said as it is, it usually responds to the supplemental oxygen. Yep, guys. So for question number 63, the diagnosis of the patient will be bagasosis, hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Hypersensitivity pneumonitis in sugarcane would be seen with thermophilic actinomyositis. The answer to this question will be option number C. Yep, good spotted by everybody. Those of you who have still answered as A, that was a previous MCI question, no? Hepatocellular carcinoma, that was asked with respect to a patient having a liver cancer, right? Aflatoxin A. So aflatoxin is one that you read with liver cancer. That was MCI exam last time that they asked about it. But I have talked about HCC. I have talked about hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Okay, fine. Let's move to the next one. In which shock CVP is increased? So in the earlier part, I taught you that shock with increased cardiac output is going to be septic shock, as we have discussed earlier. Then we have shock with bradycardia. And then we have shock with increased CVP. Can I have quick comments in the chat box for the answer, please, while I just fill up the remaining ones? A person having neurogenic shock would be having bradycardia. Yes, guys, in which shock would you be having an increase in central venous pressure? Absolutely. Shock with elevated CVP would be seen in cardiogenic shock and also in obstructive shock. The correct answer for question number 64 will be given as Bombay. Guys, you again missed it out. A couple of people missed it out here. I mean, still answered A. मतलब बताया था मैंने CO नहीं है पहले CVP cardiac output वाला बोला ना यार मैंने अभी CVP वाला बोला. So you need to remember that, figure that things out, right? 64 गलत नहीं होना चाहिए था यार. आई मीन आई एक्सपेक्ट यू गाइस टू गेट इट स्पॉट ऑन एट एनी पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम. दिस डेफिनेटली शुड नॉट गो रॉन्ग. ऑब्स्ट्रक्टिव शॉक के एग्जांपल्स भी पूछ लेते हैं, कई बार लिख देता है. कार्डियक टैम्पोनेट एंड टेंशन न्यूमोथोरैक्स आर टू सिनेरियोस व्हिच दे लव टू आस्क यू रिगार्डिंग फॉर सीवीपी. वी मूव टू द नेक्स्ट वन. Patient has a history of vomiting. Doctor gave antiemetic. I have already given a hint for that question in the earlier part of discussion. कि आपने पेरिनॉम लगाया पेशेंट को मेटोक्लोप्रोमाइड और उसके बाद में मोटर सिम्टम्स आ गए. दैट इज एक्स्ट्रा पिरामिडल सिंड्रोम. देर विल बी इम्बैलेंस बेसिकली. दैट इज डोपामिन लेस हो जाता है और एसिटाइल कोलिन इंक्रीज हो जाता है. Basically, what he's saying is that when you give metoclopramide, anti-vomiting drug to the patient, especially pediatric cases, there can be EPS developing in the patient. And whenever there is going to be an EPS occurring in the patient, there would be imbalance with dopamine values becoming lesser and acetylcholine values increasing. So I'm waiting for you guys to answer, and I am getting very surprising answers, considering the fact that इसमें तो यार कोई इशू नहीं होना चाहिए. मतलब हायोसिन क्यों दोगे यार, मोशन सिकनेस थोड़ी ना भाई. द करेक्ट आंसर फॉर दिस क्वेश्चन वुड बी बेंजोक्सॉल. द आंसर इज व्हाई, बिकॉज बेंजोक्सॉल इज एंटीकोलिनर्जिक ड्रग. सो दिस विल डेफिनेटली बी, आई मीन यू वुड बी इन अ वेरी गुड पोजिशन टू हैंडल दिस पेशेंट इफेक्टिवली. आंसर टू क्वेश्चन नंबर 65 इज बॉम्बे. इन केस यू मिस्ड इट, रीड दिस एस्पेक्ट अगेन. नो 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 यार, लेवोडोपा तो पार्किंसन में देंगे ना, इसमें तो दोगे क्यों? डोपामिन कम नहीं, इसमें डोपामिन नहीं बढ़ाना है इसको, इसमें डोपामिन नहीं बढ़ाना है सर, इसमें एसिटाइल कोलिन को कम करना है ताकि दोनों न्यूरो ट्रांसमीटर्स का बैलेंस हो जाए ना, राइट? सो डू टेक केयर ऑफ दैट. नो दैट दिस इज ईपीएस एक्स्ट्रा पिरामिडल सिंड्रोम बेसल गैंग्लिया एस्पेक्ट दैट इज अकर्ड इम्बैलेंस दैट इज अकर्ड. ओके जी, कमिंग टू द नेक्स्ट वन. हेड एक इन जॉइंट सेल आर्टेराइटिस विल बी ट्रीटेड विद विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग. सो आई मीन जॉइंट सेल आर्टेराइटिस वुड बी हैविंग इन्वॉल्वमेंट ऑफ द ऑरिकुलो टेम्पोरल आर्टरी. दे वुड बी टेम्पोरल हेड एक इन अ पर्सन. इट्स अ वैस्कुलाइटिस. और जितनी भी वास्कुलाइटिस होते हैं, रूमेटोलॉजी के डिसऑर्डर्स होते हैं, उन सभी में हम स्टेरॉइड्स तो यूज करते ही करते हैं. यस गाइस, क्विक आंसर्स प्लीज. आई थिंक आई हैव ऑलरेडी सेड इट. 66 प्लीज. एब्सोल्युटली वील गिव स्टेरॉइड्स मैन एंड द पर्सन विल डेफिनेटली इम्प्रूव. जॉइंट सेल आर्टेराइटिस इज अ एक्स्ट्रा क्रैनियल कॉज ऑफ हेडेक. यू गेट अ टेम्पोरल आर्टेराइटिस इन दिस केस. इट्स द टेम्पोरल आर्टरी दैट बिकम्स नैरोड. इट इज द रेटिनल आर्टरी दैट विल गेट नैरोड. सो दैट डेफिनेटली कैन कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू, यू नो आई मीन, हेडेक इन अ पेशेंट, और इट कैन इवन कॉज ब्लाइंडनेस इन द पेशेंट एज वेल. For every vasculitis, we always give steroids. एक वेगनर्स को छोड़ दो. I mean, for granulomatosis with polyangiitis, वेगनर्स granulomatosis is old name. So for GPA, we usually give cyclophosphamide. Otherwise, in most of the vasculitis, the first answer is steroids only. Okay. Answer to 66 is alpha. We come to 67, which is the leading problem seen in old age patients. After 65 years of age, which is the commonest problem, and obviously. I mean, all of these would can happen, but then which of these is the commonest one? Waiting for inputs from you guys, and I know that I'm gonna get lots of varied answers for this one. Yes, guys, quickly we'll be reaching towards the end of the discussion, so I think you guys can speed up the process. Okay. Fine. So we have sleep disturbances. Okay. In fact, I even had a dementia coming up. More people, please. Okay, fine. So it's not dementia, guys. Put it all around your, look around your family, look at around your society. Is it that everybody is having dementia? No, definitely not. Is everybody leaking bladder? No, it's only the women postmenopausal who had 3 children or more they would be having, I mean, mainly stress incontinence, or they could be having overflow incontinence. So it has to be between these two. It's either going to be recurrent falls or it's going to be sleep disturbances. So both are very common, but the answer to this, guys, is not alpha, is not option number A, which Alzheimer's disease, which guys are mentioning. This is textbook reference, guys. The answer is recurrent falls, especially in old age. The ability to maintain balance can be affected, and these patients can sustain injuries. And that is when most of these patients come to us. They could be having coleus fracture. They could be having avascular necrosis of the head to the femur. So recurrent falls is one of the leading problems that we see in geriatric age group. After that comes urinary incontinence, then comes sleep disturbances, and then comes dementia. So Alzheimer itna common nahi hai na sir. And urinary incontinence maine kaise rule out kiya? I mean, I ruled out urinary incontinence by saying that only the female gender will be having mainly the problem, no? Because male patient mein to urgency aa rahi hoti hai, usme urine pass out nahi hota na, usme to urine aata hi nahi. By if you are saying BPH, no, in a person with benign prostatic hyperplasia, what is the problem? It is urgency. He says, I need to go to the washroom right now. But when he goes to the urine, when he goes to the bathroom, it is not that the urine will be leaked in his underpants only. Wo bolega ki urine drop karke aata, dribbling, and because it's an obstructive uropathy. Obviously, if it's an old man with overactive bladder, you see, there are two separate problems. One is overactive bladder, like aapne dekha hoga old age mein, both men and women have overactive bladder, and for that we are giving bladder relaxants. And lot of old people, they tend to go to the washroom again and again. Like, you know, you are going on a holiday, then they every 2 hours they'll say, okay, stop the car, and you have to stop at a dhaba restaurant, and the old person in the family will go to the washroom, because obviously old age mein the bladder capacity and the ability to hold bladder becomes lesser. So lot of old people suffer from overactive bladder. But in females, it is usually stress incontinence ki cuffing karne pe urine nikal jata hai, aur males mein BPH present hota hai, to usme urine aata nahi hai. So that is why urinary incontinence jo term hai na, ki soiling of the underclothes of the patient, that is relatively less common, kyunki males mein to incontinence hai nahi. It's rather dribbling which is present. So if we go by the data, it is recurrent falls which is the commonest geriatric problem. So let's move to the next one. I mean, I gave you easy ones. I have the right to introduce a couple of them which you are not able to score. Okay, ji, which of the following is a leading cause of subtle seizure? Subtle seizure is what is seen in neonates. So the aspect of epilepsy that I've handled comes in handy here. Waiting for comments from you guys. Yes, guys. Waiting for inputs from you. What is the number one cause of subtle seizures? Yeah, subtle mein kya hoga? Bachcha wo kya karega? Jahan pe pediatrician kya batayega? Ko jitteriness. Jitteriness mein kya hai ki baby jo hai wo arms ki movement kar raha hai, legs ki movement kar raha hai, to boxing kar raha hai. To maa baap to bade khush ho rahe hain ki dekho hamara bachcha boxer banega, cycling hai, ya fir wo pouting of the lips kar raha hai. To jaise girl baby hai to mother keh rahi hai dekho abhi se selfie pose bana raha hai. सो पाउटिंग ऑफ द लिप्स हो गया, साइकिलिंग हो गया, बॉक्सिंग हो गया. तो बच्चा जो है ऐसा नहीं कि ग्रॉस वायलेंट मूवमेंट होती है. सटल सीजर बेसिकली मीन्स माइनर मैनिफेस्टेशंस. इट इज माइनर, आई वुड से समथिंग अ लिटल मोर देन ट्रेमर एंड लेसर देन अ कन्वल्जन. कन्वल्जन इज वायलेंट जर्किंग. सो आई एम सेइंग गो डाउन अ फ्यू नॉचेस बाय कन्वल्जन एंड गो अप अ कपल नॉचेस बाय ट्रेमर, बिकॉज ट्रेमर विल बी माइल्ड राइट एंड कन्वल्जन विल बी वायलेंट. तो दोनों के बीच में बोल रहा हूं. On one spectrum is convulsion, on one hand is a tremor. Dono ke beech mein I am saying is jitteriness of a child. The leading cause of subtle seizures would be birth asphyxia. It is hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, following which, no guys, it's not high grade fever. High grade fever is a cause of febrile seizures. Agar maine aapse pucha hota ki bhai what causes febrile seizure, you will say genetic susceptibility to high grade fever. Bhai bachpan mein aapko mujhko bhi tez bukhar hua hoga. There might be a possibility that your mom and your dad would have told you that okay, when you were 5, 6, 7, whatever age, you suddenly once in your life आपको 103, 104, 105 बुखार हो गया. पर क्या आपको कन्वर्जन हुए? नहीं. तो normally बच्चों में तेज बुखार होना is a normal thing, but in some children there is a decreased cerebral threshold. What I mean by that is that there is a genetic susceptibility to the fact that there is an abnormal neuronal activation. पूरा brain का synchronous discharge start हो जाता है in response to high grade fever, which does not happen in you and me. तो हाई ग्रेड फीवर तो यार फेब्राइल कन्वर्जन करता है ना. जो कि बच्चों में मिलते हैं, मैंने तो सबटल सीजर पूछे जो कि न्यूनेट्स में मिलते हैं, एंड उसका सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट कॉज क्या है, द लीडिंग कॉज फॉर दैट गाइस इज बर्थ एस्फिक्सिया, इट इज हाइपोक्सिक इश्केमिक एनसेफेलोपैथी। तो सीजर्स का टॉपिक एक बार फिर से देखिए, और उसमें एज ग्रुप वाइज आई हैव डिस्क्राइब दैट यू बेसिकली नीड टू वर्कआउट द इंफॉर्मेशन। आई स्टिल हैड वेरियड रिस्पॉन्स गाइज, इवन ऑन द चैनल, द यूट्यूब चैनल, आई मीन हाइपोग्लाइसीमिया इज सब्सिक्वेंटली बडी, इट इज नॉट इमिजिएट। ओके, आंसर 268 इज सी। वी कम टू 69, विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग इज अ पुअर प्रोग्नोस्टिक फैक्टर फॉर मल्टीपल माइलोमा। दिस इज अ प्लाज्मा सेल डिसऑर्डर, आई मीन देयर इज अ ट्रायड, प्लाज्मा सेल्स मोर देन 10% कैन गो अप टू 60% ऑल्सो, एम स्पाइक एंड क्रैब फीचर्स वुड बी प्रेजेंट, एज आई एक्सप्लेन क्रैब फीचर्स होने चाहिए, देन सीरम इलेक्ट्रोफोरेसिस का रिपोर्ट आना चाहिए, दैट इज शोइंग एम स्पाइक, एंड ऑब्वियसली प्लाज्मा सेल्स इन द बोन मैरो, द काउंट्स गो अप हायर हायर हायर, आई मीन गो अप टू 60% एंड इवन हायर ऑल्सो, दो इन द ट्रायड इवन 10% इज सफिशियंट। अगर ट्रायड सेटिस्फाई नहीं हो रहा तब हम 60% क्राइटेरिया यूज करते हैं। आई वांट टू हाईलाइट दिस वंस अगेन गाइस, अगर ये ट्रायड सेटिस्फाई नहीं होता है देन वी कैन यूज 60% क्राइटेरिया, बट इफ द ट्रायड इज सेटिस्फाइड इवन 10% इज सफिशियंट फॉर डायग्नोसिस, सो डोंट बी अंडर इंप्रेशन दैट मल्टीपल माइलोमा ओनली 60% इज द कट ऑफ। If the triad is satisfied, even 10% is sufficient for diagnosis. If the triad is not satisfied, the question says poor prognostic factor for these patients, that would be a urinary marker. A very good answer by almost everybody, that is urinary beta 2 microglobulin. Yep, it's not serum creatinine, right? It would be a urinary beta 2 microglobulin. Yes. Locked in syndrome is Michael Shoemaker Mayur. I have discussed that in the AB of Michael Shoemaker's case, where the in locked in syndrome, it is a person may have spontaneous breathing. In locked in syndrome, a person will be only having inability to use cranial nerves and hands and arms, that is corticospinal tract. I want to highlight this once again. Locked in syndrome may multiple cranial nerve palsies would be present and corticospinal tract injurement. So therefore he will not be used to use his arms, use his legs, can't speak, can't drink, can't eat, but can blink. Brain dead person cannot blink. Brain dead person cannot move his eyes. Brain dead person will not have spontaneous breathing, but locked in syndrome can have spontaneous breathing. So that's one of the difference that is present. Answer to question number 69 is Bombay. We move to the next one. Patient of STEMI in RCA territory should be treated with thrombolysis within how much time frame? Yes, guys. I mean, thrombolysis is done either in AIS or for patients with STEMI. What's the upper limit? Okay. So, just because आप carefully नहीं पढ़ोगे, मैंने आपको 4.5 आवर्स किसके लिए बताया हुआ है सर? STEMI के लिए बताया हुआ है कि acute ischemic stroke के लिए बताया हुआ है? For the boys in my group or boys and girls in my group, please let me know कि भाई मैंने आपको बोला था मैं CNS का टॉपिक डिस्कस करूंगा आपसे, तो मैंने CNS को डिस्कस कर रहा हूं मैं आपसे, नो डाउट अबाउट इट, बट जरूरी थोड़ी ना मैं क्वेश्चन थोड़ा सा तो ट्विस्ट कर सकता हूं यार। I've given you sufficient opportunities to score easy in those questions. 4.5 hours is cut off for acute ischemic stroke. Read the question, guys. This is a big silly mistake. It is STEMI. STEMI में कितने घंटे देते हैं? 12 घंटे सर। वो डोर टू नीडल टाइम है यार, जो 30 मिनट्स होता है, डोर टू बेलून टाइम 90 मिनट्स होता है। स्टेमाई में थ्रोम्बोलाइसिस इज 12 आवर्स। देर आर टू ट्रीटमेंट्स फॉर स्टेमाई, वन इज दैट यू हैव अ कैथ लैब फैसिलिटी अवेलेबल, इफ यू हैव अ कैथ लैब फैसिलिटी अवेलेबल यू विल डू अ बेलून एंजियोप्लास्टी विद इन 90 मिनट्स, दैट इज व्हाट यू आर आंसरिंग राहुल। इफ आई डोंट हैव अ कैथ लैब फैसिलिटी I will do thrombolysis in the patient. That is door to needle time. That should be 30 minutes. मैंने तो ये पूछा ही नहीं। मैंने आपसे ये पूछा, what is the upper limit? Within 30 minutes, if patient comes within 30 minutes, I mean whenever patient comes within 30 minutes, I have to start. But suppose somebody had STEMI at 8 a.m. Somebody had STEMI at 8 a.m. If he comes at 12 p.m., I will start thrombolysis by 12:30. If he comes at 4 p.m., I will start thrombolysis by 4:30. I said, what is the upper limit by beyond which I will not do thrombolysis? Because after 12 hours, if somebody will survive. Either the clot has disintegrated by itself. Either the clot has disintegrated by itself. The anti-clotting mechanisms have already disintegrated the clot, or maybe somebody gave him heparin injection that resulted in disintegration. So the upper limit of thrombolysis is 12 hours. Please get this very correct. And I've highlighted this separately for a person who's having stroke, ischemic variety, it is 4.5 hours. For the STEMI, it is huge 12 hours upper limit. Is 12 hours ke andar dhyan sunna, is 12 ghante ke andar patient kabhi bhi aaye, you have to start thrombolysis within half an hour of arrival. So door to needle time is for doctor. Door to needle time is for doctor, that you have to start treatment within that particular time frame. But patient has a big flexibility, up to 12 hours kabhi bhi ghumta ghumta aapke paas mein aa jayega. And why not after 12 hours? Because the clot has spontaneously disintegrated. Agar clot khud se destroy ho gaya to aapko thrombolysis karne ka koi point nahi hai. Rather you might cause a brain hemorrhage in the chap. The answer to this question is delta. Avinash, that would be a bit controversial. That's given in cardiology books, 12 to 24 hours. That is something which is a level of evidence B, LOE B. So I would not like to quote that. I mean, it's not a good idea to discuss Braunwald at this particular point of time. So mere it's a live session, so it has to be listened here only. You can watch it anytime at your convenience. And in the app, we cannot interact, right? In the app, it's like one-way communication. This is two-way communication. Okay, gee. So we come to the last one for today. A CT abdomen of a patient is showing ureteric stone in the middle of the right ureter. I would say applied question. And the question says, the stone is in the middle of the right ureter. The patient's pain will radiate too. So I'll just highlight this before you. I mean, this is right. The stone is present. This is the bladder here. The stone is present midway and it's stuck. I mean, any stone is 6 millimeter, it would be stuck here. If it's less than 5 millimeter, it can undergo a spontaneous expulsion. The question says the pain will be related to. Okay, so I'm getting multiple answers here. Usually the answer that I'm getting is scrotum, which is not the correct answer. In fact, this would be, I would say, a combination of anatomy. Umbilicus nahi yaar, dekho, jo bhi renal pain hoti hai na, aap flank pain se mix kar rahe ho. Agar kisi ko ye umbilicus hai, agar kisi ko flank pain ho raha hai renal colic mein, to flank pain radiates to the umbilicus. That is the standard presentation of renal colic, right? This MCQ is not on renal colic. This MCQ is on ureteric colic. To pehle to, I think, you have to read my stones wala topic again, because I have highlighted the fact that renal colic and ureteric colic, they radiate in different ways. Renal colic mein wo aise yaar, agar if camera is a little higher up, but wo aise haath rakhega lower part of the chest pe, lower part of the chest pe, with mainly focusing on the lower back, and wo bolega pain is coming towards the umbilicus. That is renal colic. In ureteric colic, the pain radiates. And यहाँ पर क्या है, फंडा क्या है कि अगर स्टोन अपर यूरेटर में होता है तो पेन इज रेफर्ड टू द टेस्टिस. इफ द स्टोन इज इन द मिडल यूरेटर, देन इलियो हाइपोगैस्ट्रिक नर्व से इट कैन रेडिएट टू द इलियक फोसा, विच इज द आंसर टू दिस क्वेश्चन. इट कैन मिमिक अपेंडिसाइटिस. इफ द स्टोन इज इन द लोअर यूरेटर गाइज, देन द प्लेन कैन रेडिएट टू द थाई, स्क्रोटम एंड द पेरिनियम. अगर आपने FMG solution से last के tables पढ़ाए ना, तो उसमें mentioned है ये वाला fact. ऐसा नहीं है कि मैं कहीं बाहर से बोल रहा हूँ. I mentioned that in the book also. Stone in upper ureter, testis. But if it is lower ureter, it is scrotum and the thigh and the perineum. Right? Difference is sir, ilioinguinal nerve. और आपसे ये पूछ सकता है ना, ये वाला नाम तो, he loves to ask about anatomy and surgery together ना. So he can put it. So towards the end of this discussion, I put a slightly difficult one for you. And in fact, this on the right can mimic even appendicitis also. Right iliac fossa में pain होगा ना उसको. Answer to 71 is option number Bombay. Was a difficult one, वो डेलिबरेटली पुट इन फैक्ट बिकॉज आई गेव यू द इजियर वंस इन द मिडल ऑफ द डिस्कशन. सो विद दिस गाइज आई एम सॉर्टेड फॉर टुडे. थैंक यू फॉर योर पेशेंस एंड हियरिंग मी आउट. इट्स बीन ऑलमोस्ट 3.5 hours प्लस दैट वी हैव बीन सिटिंग एंड डिस्कसिंग ऑल दिस. सो दैट्स वट आई थिंक दैट यू गाइज कैन डू. आई मीन सिट दैट लॉन्ग, कंटिन्यूसली फोकस ऑन क्वेश्चन, डू देम अगेन एंड अगेन एंड अगेन, फोकस ऑन योर वीकनेसेस एंड यू विल बी एबल टू वर्क इट आउट. I want to tell you everybody that approximately 10 to 15 questions in the paper of yours, whichever exam that you're sitting, the current pattern that they're giving will always be bouncers. Those bouncers will always contribute to you losing concentration and focus, and aapko ye lagega ki hame kuch nahi aata aur uski wajah se baki paper kharab ho jata. This is what happens in almost every paper, every feedback that I'm getting for last 1 year. So my humble request to you guys is, don't get bogged down by these bouncers. This is always going to happen. 10 to 15 to 20 questions will always be like this. They are deliberately designed to upset your rhythm. And as I say, mental toughness is something where 10 questions go wrong and you still get the 11th one right. So that would be the preaching part from my side towards the end of this discussion. Thank you so much. And I'll put this discussion in the group as well. Thanks Rahul for the kind words, and I'll be signing out. Bye bye, take care, God bless you.